You know, Michael, a little sad note here. A lot of people may know already, but Joe Saravo, terrific guy and a terrific actor who played Johnny Boy Soprano.
Played Tony Soprano's father in all those great flashback scenes and played that character just perfectly.
And he was going to be a guest on our podcast. I had spoke to his manager, I guess about a month and a half, 6 weeks ago. And Joe had just gotten operated. And he said when he's feeling better, he wanted to come on. Please save him a spot. And I said, it's wide open. When everyone's come on, me and Michael would love to speak to him. And I was looking forward to it. And unfortunately, I read, as we all have, Joe passed away after a really tough, long battle with cancer.
Yeah, it's really tragic. He was a fantastic
really
actor. And a
sweet
guy. He is an actor's actor. He did a lot of work on Broadway, film and television, Jersey Boys. He did the national tour. He was in Nick Sandow's movie, The Wannabe, which I also had a part in, as did John Ventimiglia. He played John Gotti.
Yeah.
For me and for my money, I put it on him. I think he played Gotti better than anyone who's done it before. I really liked what he did with that role. And
it's sad. He said he has a daughter and a granddaughter.
And a sweetheart of a guy.
Really nice New York guy. Really nice guy, man. It's just a shame. And I feel really bad about this. So we just want to salute.
And on behalf of the Soprano family, because everybody feels the same way, we send our deepest condolences to his family and to all his friends. And he will be missed.
Rest in peace, Joe. Hey, man.
What's up, buddy? How are you?
Pretty good. Like I said, it's baseball season, my friend. Baseball's starting up again, and I'm happy. I hope maybe we could get to a game this year.
We went 2 years ago. We went to a few together. It was a lot of fun. Going to Yankee Stadium is always great. I don't care. Going to see the Yankees, it's always very special. I love it. I hope we go.
Maybe this
year. Speaking of baseball, we got a doubleheader today. We have two special guests. We have Matt Del Negro, who played Carmelo's cousin, the financial wizard Brian Cammarata. And
great character.
We also have Chris Caldovino, who played Billy Leotardo, brother of Phil Leotardo, played by the late, great Frank Vincent.
Yeah, two good guys, two great characters, and I'm looking forward to talking to both of them today.
Okay, our next guest was born, as I was and as David Chase was, in Westchester County, New York. He was up in Mount Kisco. David and I were both born in Mount Vernon. He played Division I college lacrosse at BC, Boston College. Yeah, so he was a damn good lacrosse player. I played lacrosse, but I was not good. He is an actor. He's a teacher. He's a podcaster and an author. He has appeared in 84 different film and TV shows, including The West Wing, Teen Wolf, Scandal, Mistresses, Goliath, and now City on the Hill with Kevin Bacon, a really good TV show. In 2017, he launched his own podcast, which is now a book called 10,000 No's, How to Overcome Rejection on the Way to Your Yes. Comes in very handy if you're pursuing acting, because you'll get a lot of no's like we did, Steve.
Yes, sir.
He appeared in 8 episodes of The Sopranos as Carmela's cousin, the financial wizard, Brian Cammarata. Please welcome our very special guest, Mr. Matt Del Negro.
There he is.
There he is.
Thank you guys so much.
Matt.
You actually, how are you, Steve?
Good to see you.
You guys,
buddy,
actually made me sound somewhat impressive there, Michael.
Yeah.
I'm going to have you introduce me more often.
Thank you very much.
A lot of things, man.
You've got a ton of credits, man. A ton of credits. So how do you go from being a Division I lacrosse player to an actor?
Well, where did you go to high school, by the way? Where did you play lacrosse?
John Jay High School. I played football and lacrosse there.
Because I played soccer in Brewster, New York, Well, I lived there when I was high school.
Good.
We played against John Jay in college. Yeah.
Brewster, those guys hit hard in football. Yeah, they hit hard in football, Brewster. My bowl game in college high school bowl game was in Mount Vernon at Memorial Stadium. You remember that?
Oh, well. Yeah. I know it well.
Yeah. So no, Steve, you said, how do you do? You get broken up with by a girl in Italy. That's how you, and then you fill a journal with all of your midlife crisis stuff, 19 going on 20. That's what happened to me. I was basically no idea I was going to do this. I was over in Italy between sophomore and junior year of college. My sister gave me a journal, came in handy. I ended up unloading into this journal. And one of the things in that was, maybe I want to be a writer. Maybe I want to be an actor, but it was like totally out of nowhere. You know, I was like trying to stuff it back down, got back to BC, played lacrosse, and then fall ball junior year. Remember just like running around the practice field and thinking, man, I wish I just rolled my ankle. I don't want to be here. And I was like, that's kind of crazy. You're not on a scholarship. I went to the coach. I said, I think I'm done. He said, think about it. I said, I have. And then I went out for a play that spring. And I think everybody was like, what's going on with Del Negro? What's he doing a play for? And I did this one act, William Saroyan, Hello Out There. It was like not even in a real, on a stage. It was like in a lecture hall at Boston College. And I was just like, this is what I'm going to do. And I just, wow. I was an English major. I got a film studies minor, and I just told anybody that would listen I was going to be an actor, but I really had no clue what I was doing, you know?
So just like that, you just decided and you did it. No bullshit.
I just kind of like, it was like, it, you know, when they say like it catches, you know, you get the call or it grabs you, you don't grab it. That's really what happened with me. And in retrospect, I look back now, it makes a lot more sense. But at the time it was like, holy shit. Like it was literally like when I was in Italy, I wanted to stuff this down. I didn't really want to deal with it, but you know, it makes sense now. And there's a guy in my town that did a youth group through the church, and he was an actor. He's like the only actor I knew. And I looked up to him. He's, you know, great wife, three daughters, like just a cool guy. And so it makes sense to me now, but it was totally out of left field. Yeah.
What were you doing in Italy?
I was studying. So I was supposed to, you know, like in college, people sometimes would go abroad the spring of junior year. And some upperclassmen had gone to Australia. And I remember hearing, I've still never been to Australia, but I remember hearing about like beaches and palm trees. And I'm like, that's where I want to go. And then I realized that would be during the season, which is in the spring. So instead I went to Perugia, which is a little town in the mountains, and I just went to study Italian, and because I'm 100%, and you know, my grandmother spoke it, and I started taking it in college when it was offered, because in high school they just had I took like Latin and Spanish, started taking Italian. I went there, and the irony was this breakup happened, and I really didn't go to class, which is not like me at all, but I was literally I found this church, and I would go to the grass and like fill this journal. I literally was like, I've never had another experience like that in my life.
You were devastated. She knocked you for a loop, huh?
Totally. Yeah.
Where is she these days?
She, you know, it's funny, man. It wasn't her so much as it was my, like, I think I had rumblings of it. Not really. I was very like naive and young. I think I had rumblings of it not being what I thought it was before that trip. And then she was just able to say it before I said it, but I wasn't ready for it at the time. And it just kind of, I think I had a bunch of stuff like that was just stuffed down and, you know, growing up that all came out.
Well, thank God she dumped you. Otherwise we wouldn't be talking to you today.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Exactly. Did you finish school? Did you finish BC?
I did. I finished BC. I graduated in 94. I moved home to Westchester that summer, lived with my mom, worked with a mason laying patios, made some money, did a audition for this a musical actually in Connecticut, did the Mystery of Edwin Drood, met a girl through that play, got me a job waiting tables in Stamford, Connecticut, at some pizza place, started taking the train into the city two nights a week for acting classes. Saved up money by that January. I moved into the city January 1st of 95.
Where'd you take acting class?
Well, those first ones, you know, they were great for me at the time because I was just excited to go, but they were not. It was Weiss Baron was that one. But then my first
that was more
place
from like commercials, right? Weiss Baron was more on.
Yeah. And then I did it was like a commercial class, and it was like, and then I did some scene study class. But then I found through my table waiting job, I found Terry Schreiber. And I went to Terry Schreiber's studio, which at the time was East 4th Street. Then they moved to West 26th. And he was great. I stayed with him for 4 years. And then I went to the Actor Center, and Ron Van Loo and Bruce Katzman. And, you know, just kind of was always in class in New York.
Yeah. When did you get your first job? Or what was your first job?
I mean, I did so many shitty jobs in the beginning that it's hard to even know which one was my first. I'd say the first... My first good job actually relates to my how Sopranos came about. I was always going through backstage. Like everything was through backstage. It was like,
me too.
You know, what you too? Yeah.
Oh yeah.
It was like, I went through, when I think about what I did, I wouldn't wish it upon anybody. Like I was like, you know, bartending at one place, waiting tables another place. I would go through backstage every week, scour
backstage
through for something.
Backstage audience is a newspaper, trade newspaper
had
auditions.
Yeah.
Mostly for student films, in sometimes independent movies, sometimes off Broadway plays, but it was the trade, and they'd have auditions. That's what
and
we
you'd
did.
Like scour through and you'd go like, oh, this one I'm kind of right for. And then I would have like a semi form cover letter that I would change the name on it. I'd tweak it a little bit. I'd staple my headshot to my shitty resume that had nothing on it but bullshit at the time. And
I changed your
send
name?
Out like,
you had different names?
No. I changed like, you know, Dear Michael, interested in your project, you know, that kind of thing. And I would do that. And most of them were terrible. And then I got this one called the North End, and it was supposed to be a non-union thing. I got the lead, and the director was a PA on Casino. He got the script to Frank Vincent, Bill Leotardo for the audience here. And Frank signed on to do it, got Tony Darrow to do it. It turned into a union thing. We shot it on location in Boston. It ended up going to Montreal Film Festival and Boston Film Festival. It was like it was a big deal to me at the time, even though, you know, now it's like, I mean, it didn't sell or anything, but it made a little bit of waves. And those guys were making another movie, and they had a lead that was a guy who was like a quarterback, an American quarterback who goes to Italy and falls in love with a girl. And they're like, you're our guy. So when we were done with the North End, I mean, I went up, I got my own bus ticket up to Boston like twice and did table reads. I was all set to go do this. They brought Georgianne Walken on as the casting director, and somehow she didn't think I was right for it. So she talked them out of using me. And I like hated her for like a couple of years. I was like, fuck her. You know, I was like, this is my job. So, you know, long story short, it came around. She brought me in for Sopranos. I went in for Sopranos several times for smaller roles, and thank God I didn't get them.
What did you read? Then, you know, for who?
You know, I read, I was trying to think of this before we got on the calls. Like, I think I read for the one that, the D girl episode that Dom Famosa ended up getting he was like out in LA, and there was a while ago.
Cousin.
Then there was like a,
he was my cousin.
Yeah.
Right?
Your cousin. Yeah. Yeah. Then I read for a guy that worked when you were involved in like the chop shop stuff, the Wall Street stuff, somebody who worked in the office there. Then I went in for like a traffic cop, like not really much of roles. And then cousin Brian came in, and I remember I was bartending at the time, and like I, you know, try to explain it to people. When I was bartending, I'd make like $300 or $400 a night. It, you know, bartending, you go do a play, like a legitimate off Broadway play, you make like $250 a week. you know, so $300 Yeah, yeah. And $300 usually most of the plays I did were nothing, you know, they were in black box theater. So I had my initial audition for Georgianne, and I gave up my bartending shift, which sounds like nothing now, but when I think about it, it's like for an initial audition, just the material was like, the bar where I worked was in Midtown, and a bunch of the guys, like, it was all like suits would come into the bar, and some of them were, you know, guys that I went to, Turtle Bay Grill and Lounge on 52nd and 2nd.
I've been there many times.
Okay. I'm sure we've been drunk in there at some point.
I used to play at the OTB a lot on 2nd Avenue and 50. You know, there was an OTB right over there around the corner for a minute.
Yeah, right around the corner from us. Yeah.
Go there and go back and forth, you know, between races.
That's so funny. I never saw you. Yeah, I was in there. I was like a fixture in there, man. So anyway, I got the material and it was all this financial jargon. And like, I knew enough guys that did this that I felt like, and I was bartending, I was with all these guys I went to college with, worked on Wall Street. I was like, I got to be able to do this better than a lot of people. Like, I feel like, and also just the character, I felt like I just had a shot. I felt like I had a shot enough to where I was like, I'm giving up my shift. I'm going in. I went in for Georgianne, and to her credit, she did think I was right for this. And she really kind of, I feel like she was integral in like whatever she had to do to pitch me to them. But I ended up going back for the producers, which I had been a bunch of times before for those other roles. But I went in, I felt good. And then my agents at the time were like, the next week, they were like, hey, you're the front runner for this thing. And I was like, holy shit, wait, for the Sopranos? You know, like the Sopranos, as you guys know, but the Sopranos was like, no way. Like, as soon as I heard I was kind of close, I thought, holy crap, like, no way. Come on, really? And they go, we want you to come back in one more time just to make sure. And I was like, fuck. I go back and it's just me and like there's two other names on the sheet. And they were, I was at the small agent and it was like CAA and, you know, William Morris or something. And I'm like, oh, they're bringing in the big gun. They're going to just give, this is bullshit. They're going to give it to some, you know, whatever. And I'm sitting there kind of like just going, like getting in the zone. And this guy comes by and goes, and I look up, he goes, relax, kid. And I look up and it's David Chase. And he walks into the room and I was like, you fucking relax, David. I was like, holy shit.
I'm surprised he said anything to you. I'm surprised he said anything.
Yeah, he tapped me. He goes, relax, kid. He goes, it's funny because I was listening to some of your other interviews on this show. And I think hearing other actors say that he didn't talk to them much, like I think I was so young. I just thought like I was on the outskirts of the whole show. It sounds like everybody was like, he was enigmatic, you know, but I had a couple of little conversations with him and he was, you know, I mean, what a, it's like just to even be sitting here talking to you guys, this was such a huge, huge, huge part of my life and career. And it was, you know, it's weird. Like, Michael, I think about you started with the show. So you probably have a different relationship to it because you just got a pilot. You didn't know it was going to be what it was. But like for me, I was late in the game, fourth season. It was just so huge that when I got it, I was like, holy shit, I'm going to be, you know, like it was so surreal, the entire thing.
When you got were you offered one episode, or would they say it's going to be a couple episodes, or what was the situation?
So that was the good news. When I got that audition, it had scenes from, I think, like four different episode. So I knew I was going to be in whatever it was. I knew I was going to be there for a while. And I also, I think they said it's going to be at least four. And I was like, from the writing could tell it couldn't just be what I knew from the audition. It had to be more than that. The way it looked like there was like a little bit of a more to do. So I knew I was going to, you know, it was the biggest get that I'll probably ever have in my life, because not only the show, but where I was in my life, I was so naive and like I had just gotten engaged. I had just gone through, you know, 9/11. We lost two guys I bartended with that, you know, so it was like, I got engaged August of 2001. 9/11 happened a couple of weeks later. That fall, as you guys know, was just bananas. And then I got Sopranos like December 20th of 2001, shot it that whole winter and spring. And then it came out, like my stuff started airing a week after my wedding. So my wow. wife and I were at Radio City Music Hall the night before our rehearsal dinner. Like it was,
wow.
it was bananas. You know, it was like a really weird kind of whirlwind part of my life. And you know, I was kind of starstruck, psyched, you know, first time I didn't have to explain to people that I was an actor, you know?
Yeah. You know, it's amazing, but you know, it's amazing. You know, you're reared for these small roles. And of course, if you would have got the traffic cop, you would have taken it and that would have been the end of that. It's amazing totally. How things happen. You know, I mean, I read for FBI agent Skip Lapari, you know, you would have took the one. Yeah, Sopranos. I got one episode. You'd be happy to do it. A co-star thing. And these are happy accidents. Thank goodness you didn't get that. You know,
totally. No, you know, I have a better one was I went in for not too far before it. I went in for like a regular role on a soap. And I went and I remember thinking I screen tested. I was in Brooklyn on their stages and I thought I was going to get it. I didn't get it. I was totally bummed out. And I'm like, thank God I did not get that. And I got Sopranos. Like, that's the wild thing about what we do is, you know, it can be, I mean, trust me, I have been pummeled with the best of them. And it gets dark, but it's also exciting that you don't know what's next. And you really don't know, you know?
Well, yeah, I think a lot of people don't realize, maybe they do, you know, the uncertainty that you live with as an act. You know, it's one thing to have a job. It's another thing we deal with. You do a job and then it's over and you don't know necessarily when your next job is going to be. Once you get used, you do get used to it as an actor, but it's always hard.
Totally.
Just I mean, I you don't know.
Yeah. Present day. I'm working on a show right now. Hopefully it gets another season. It might not. I'm literally making an audition tape for something else right now in the meantime, because even if that comes back, it's not for a while. I don't think people realize them. They're like, oh, you do that? Like, what do you mean an audition tape? You're like, yeah, in the time of COVID, this is what you're doing.
You know, they don't know. Yeah, you still got to audition. You know how many times I've heard that? Yeah, I've got to audition. You know, either that or you don't work, you know. That's the thing. You know, I mean, people assume you're working and you don't have to audition, that once you're in, you know, this thing, you're always in. And we know as actors that that's the furthest thing from the truth. Unless you're a huge star, you continue to have to keep looking for work and doing whatever it is you have to do. But after The Sopranos, now you work with Jim, though, a lot. Mostly Jim, right? Jim and Edie. That must have been great.
It was awesome. Yeah, it was all Jim and Edie, really. They were in probably every scene that I was in had at least one of them. So I felt like, you know, for a young actor, not only on camera, but seeing them operate off camera was like a masterclass, you know? I mean, I feel like I have little, you know, little stories of stuff, you know, more, maybe even more so Jim, but just, you know, it was incredible. Yeah. It was incredible.
Do you remember your first day on set?
Yeah. I think I shot out of order. I think Pie of My was, I don't know if that was my first episode, but that was my first day. And I was at the Aqueduct racetrack and I was sitting, it was freezing cold. It was like January or February. And I'm sitting in my like four banger, which people listening, that's like a trailer, but it's certainly like, it's like a, basically a glorified port-a-john. And it was kind of cold. It was really, you know, cramped. It smelled like, you know, like the like it smells like a port-a-john. Yeah. And I called my wife and I was like, so at the time, you know, fiance at the time. And I called her. She's not in this business at all. And she's like, how's it going? And I said, you know, it's good. I'm here. I'm just trying to stay calm, whatever. She goes, why don't you go up to the set? Which was the greatest advice. I go up because it's freezing out there. I go up And I get, they're shooting, like Jim is shooting something with Ginsburg, his CPA. They're doing like a walk and talk. And there's a bunch of extras. And I see him for the first time up close. And it was like, my heart started going bum, 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 bum. And I started getting like sweat, you know, I'm like, holy shit, like here I am. And thank God I went up when I did. They were still rehearsing, going through it. And I just watched, and watching them totally calm my nerves. I'm like, okay, you know what you're doing. Just chill out and do it. And by the time they got to me, it was probably like 2 hours later. And we go over and we shoot the scene where we're watching the race, and it's like Joey Pants and Jim, and you know, like it's, and I just knew, because I knew I was going to be there for a while, I thought, I'm not going to kiss his ass. I'm just going to kind of be prepared, do my job, and hopefully he's going to end up liking me, but I'm not going to like ask him a bunch of questions. I'm just going to shut the fuck up and do my job. And he was cool. And he was really cool. You know, it's not like we were best friends, but he was very cool.
You remember meeting Michael?
Steve on the set. I just said, I'm not going to kiss Steve's ass. I'm not going to pretend that that I'm in awe of him. I'm just going to kind of take it easy, play it cool. And he resents that to this day.
Yeah. Listen,
I got to come to Michael's defense, because I've heard you busting his balls with other people. And I got to tell you, I shot a scene at the Bada Bing, Satin Dolls. And I was, again, you know, like this rookie, I don't know anybody. I'm just like, holy cow. You know, I just want to go in there and do a good job. And we broke for lunch. And it was this scene where I had to like do a shot. I like lick a stripper and do the shot or whatever. And Michael, I'm like, I was like a kid, and you know, it felt like I was in like middle school going through during lunch. Like, I'm going to sit by myself. He's like, hey, you want to come over and sit with me? And you invited me to sit at your table.
Bullshit.
Sat with me. So,
I remember that.
Swear to God.
That's usually how I was.
I'm not for 1 second.
Swear to God.
You're full of shit.
I can verify it, because he goes, oh, this is so-and-so. And I go, oh, and I realized she was the one I was going to be doing the shot off of. And I was like, oh, okay, it's nice to meet you.
Yeah.
So well, I was like, all right.
That's not my experience.
Positive of who I am. There you go. Thank you, Matt. Yeah.
That wasn't my experience. You must have fucking told him to do that. But that's bullshit, Matt. I'm not buying your shit. Let me ask you. So you've worked steady since the show. I mean, you've worked on, the show you're on now, City on a Hill, I love that, on Showtime. I think that's a terrific show with Kevin Bacon, and you just became a series regular, which is great. But you were on Mistresses, right? Yep. Scandal, Mistresses. I mean, you've worked pretty steady, huh?
Yeah, I've been, well, you know, again, like you look at it from the outside, there were periods, like after Sopranos, I remember when I got Sopranos, I had visions of me sitting on Letterman's couch, you know? It's like I had a whole different vision of what was going to happen. And I came out to L.A. after that. After all my stuff aired, I was like, okay, this is the time. Strike while the iron's hot. And I came out here, and it was like the busiest it's ever been. Everybody was meeting with me. People, oh, Cousin Brian, we love you. And I was like, okay, where's my show? I'm just going to sign the next thing. Got nothing. Rifled through money. Went back to New York, bartended another 2 years after Sopranos.
Wow.
Another 2 years.
People don't realize.
People would, and then I got West Wing when I was out here for pilot season, and that was supposed to be like a one and done, and they brought me back that season, and then they brought me back their last season, and that's what moved us out here.
How many West Wings did you do?
I did like 17 or something, or 19, something like that.
Wow.
Yeah, I did a lot.
That's a great show.
That was a really cool run too. I mean, between Sopranos and West Wing, and then Scandal had that kind of thing too, that I had no idea when I got it. Scandal was one where it came in as an offer, which doesn't generally happen very often. And I didn't even know what it was. And that was a huge, huge show. But West Wing and Sopranos are those shows that, like, when you go work other jobs, I would imagine you guys have this more than me, but I would be on other jobs like the West Wing, and I was like four episodes deep, and someone would be like, what was it like working on Sopranos? And I'm like, holy shit, you know, I was on Sopranos. Like everybody watched. So Sopranos is like the gift that keeps on giving. It now, was like you, the.
Now, Matt, when you're tending bar, they're recognizing you?
Yes, but it wasn't like it was that weird. There were always moments where one story I think of, which is, I think is hysterical. My wife at the time was guest bartending at some place down in the West Village. And we were there with a group, and a friend of a friend was there, and he was a huge Sopranos fan. He's like, dude, you're Tony's boy. What are you doing in the bar? And I'm like, my wife is guest bartending. I'm just hanging out. I'm like, I'm not like in TV land somewhere. Like I'm an actor who, you know, got a gig and I'm here to, you know, so you get it. Like, it was weird. I mean, that's kind of what veered me toward starting to go, like what ended up being the podcast started was I was like teaching some people. I was teaching beginning actors at the time, and then that led into the podcast. So like I've kind of looked at that. All of those setbacks have ended up being something that have kind of led me to something else. So,
and the podcast, so you turned the podcast into a book.
Yeah, that was just lucky, man. One of my guests is like a 9-time best-selling author, and he had seen a piece that I had written, and he's like, hey, do this, do that, send it to my publisher, and I think you have something here. And it was like, it's called 10,000 No's, which is what the podcast is, and that's like the one thing that happened in my career that like couldn't, everybody talks about they can't get a book deal, that actually fell in my lap. Then again, I was doing the podcast like just on my own for 3 years when that happened. So the reason I even started the whole podcast was because I was on Scandal, and something that looked like it was going to turn into a huge run just dried up immediately. And I was out of work. I felt really good about what I was doing in the rooms, but I like couldn't get arrested, and I was just pissed off. I don't want to wait for someone to hire me. I just to create. I just want to do my own thing. And so I started it. Literally, it was like, you know, I always say it's like, you know, two styrofoam cups and a string. And then it kind of built from there. I've had, you know, I had Lorraine on recently. She was great.
And Rocco. What do you do the podcast? Once a week?
I do once a week. I always do once a week, but now I've been doing these Monday morsels, which are these like little Monday mini episodes as well. So I put out two a week, and it's good, man. It keeps me.
And you do it alone.
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
Do it alone.
I do it alone. I have someone helping me now, but it's pretty much.
You know, you're lucky you don't have a partner, because sometimes it's like fucking irritating, like you have sand in your underwear when you have a partner.
I chew myself in the head. I'll tell you right now.
Oh my god. I was listening to you guys banter back and forth, and I was so jealous. I'm like, oh, that sounds like fun to be able to bust each other's balls while you're doing this. Like, you know, I'm on my own here in the hot seat.
Well, get a good friend, a really close, close friend that you know for over 20 years, and do it with him, and you'll see how that fucking turns out. Matt, I love you, man. It's great talking to you. Great seeing you. Keep up the good work, man. Really.
Really fun having you, man. Thank you for doing this. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Be well, man.
Thank you, guys. All right. Okay, take care.
Take care, pal.
See you soon.
A good guy. He's done a lot of good work, and his podcast sounds great. I'm going to tune into it.
Yeah. He's proactive. He's, you know, like you said, he's worked on really good stuff and steady. You know what I mean?
Good stuff. But like he says, 10,000 knows it. Listen, you're only as good as your last envelope. It's right. Only as good as the last show. Look at all this body of work this guy has.
It's true.
You know, you got to make it happen.
Didn't you say that about Henry Winkler said that to you? Now, he's someone who was the biggest star on TV. You said, I feel like I'm always, what, banging it out? And he says...
Yeah, he said, what's doing? I said, I'm just banging away, a little of this, a little of that. He said, you will always be banging away.
That's
and he told me that 18 years ago. And that's just how it is, man. You know,
that's how it is.
That's how it is. If you want to do this, there's no one thing. I'm going to be an actor. This is it. I'm going to ride this forever. It's never going to happen.
Never going to happen.
You know, never. Coming up, we got Billy Leotardo, played by the great Chris Caldovino. Looking forward to that. This cat I've known for quite a while, and he is a really good guy and a nice man. Born in Brooklyn, he studied at the Playhouse West under Jeff Goldblum. He's appeared in 32 different films and TV shows. Tommy, The Wolf of Wall Street, 24, Castle. He played
Tonino.
Played Tonino Santrelli on Boardwalk Empire, 15 episodes. That was right after The Sopranos. He appeared in 9 episodes of The Sopranos. Billy Leotardo, the brother of Phil Leotardo, played by the great Frank Vincent. Let's bring on Chris Caldovino from Brooklyn, New York. Chris, how are you, man?
Hey, guys. How are you?
All right, buddy.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks for doing this. We really appreciate it. So,
welcome.
So let me ask you, so you're born in Brooklyn. Did you start acting back then, or did you move to L.A. to become an actor? Tell me how this happened.
Well, I actually moved to L.A. to become an actor. I started studying in New York. In fact, when Terry Winter was on the show, he kind of mentioned the acting class that we both went to in Manhattan. It was called the Gene Frankel Theater. He couldn't remember the name, as I remember when you guys were interviewing him. And then he decided to come out to LA to be a screenwriter all of a sudden. And I secretly always wanted to act. So I said, you know, to hell with it, I'm coming with you. So he came out first, and then I joined him out here about a year later.
So you, Gene Frankel, you ever hear of him, Michael?
I heard of the studio. Did you study with him or another teacher there?
No, I studied with a guy named Jim Brick. And so, that was the first time I had went to acting, class and caught the bug.
So you liked it right from the bat. You said, let me, so you never tried auditioning and stuff in New York. You waited till you got to LA?
No, I started, I didn't audition in New York. I came out here and started auditioning. And in fact, I couldn't get an agent when I first got out here because I had no credits. So I was the only other client of Terry's fake agency. If you guys remember the story he tells. Yeah.
You were part of that fake agency. You were a real client in a fake agency.
Yes. Yes. So, I had my resumes printed up with that letterhead that he used. And, if I would get an audition or an appointment, he would make the call. And, we were living together. We were roommates at the time. So
that's very funny.
We had a blast. It was real funny.
What was the first job you got as an actor?
The first job I got, aside from like short films or aside from student films, was a movie called Femalians 2. It was, if you could call it a B movie, it was the premise was aliens come down to Earth and inhabit the bodies of strippers and wreak havoc. And I was.
Sounds like something Christopher would come up with. Christopher Moltisanti, man.
Absolutely.
At the Bada Bing. We got the girls. We'll just get some makeup, makeup people to make them look like aliens.
That sounds pretty good,
they shot
actually.
It at some nightclub. Yeah. Oh, it was hilarious. They shot it at some nightclub in LA. And I played the strip club owner. That was my role. And
you studied under Jeff Goldblum. What kind of guy is he?
Yes. He was great. I loved him. He was really intense, very passionate. And he was very involved with the students. I had really good experience.
Is that something he does like on a regular basis?
I'm not sure if he's still teaching, but that school that he was involved with is Playhouse West, and that's still around. So I don't know if he's still involved with it.
All right.
Chris, so tell me about your soprano audition. Did you read for a bunch of different roles? Tell me what happened there.
I had auditioned for Little Carmine previously, and I wasn't right for it. Ray is just, couldn't picture anybody else in that role but Ray.
Yeah.
And then when the Billy Leotardo audition came up, originally The character's name was Billy Saragusa. It wasn't Billy Leotardo. Uh-huh. And I was just going to be one of his guys. But I don't know the story. I kind of remember the day I started working, I was still Billy Saragusa through that whole day. But apparently someone, one of the producers, for some reason, either they just decided to, or that name, Billy Saragusa, wasn't, they couldn't use it, didn't clear for some reason. But they decided to name me Billy Leotardo because of, you know, while they, my, you know, working with Frank, I guess they saw a resemblance or whatever sparked that idea. And then the next, my next episode, I was Billy Leotardo, of course. But yeah, so if that didn't happen, I would have maybe did one or two episodes as
a guy in the crew.
Saragusa, just a guy in the crew.
We should just tell the audience clearing a name means like when you, the name's in the script, they have to like actually do research and see if there's somebody that can claim that name, saying you're basing this character on me, and they might sue the production or something like that. That's what that means, right. Clearing the name.
Right.
Right. Chris, so did you first read for Georgianne and Sheila and then go in for David, or did you read for David Chase?
I did. I went in and I read for David and Tim Van Patten, who I had worked for previously. I did a Frank Renzulli's pilot that Michael Rispoli starred in called Russo, and Timmy directed that. So I had worked with Timmy. I knew Timmy already, and Frankie, of course. So when I went in and read, I went right to producers. I went and I read for David and Tim, and a few other people were in there. I guess Georgianne was in there, but David was definitely there. That was real nerve wracking, actually, you know. I had no idea how I did when I walked out, as everybody else says that, you know, David doesn't really show much. But then right. I remember I was walking. I went home. I went back to my mother's house in Brooklyn, you know, where I was staying, because I was out in L.A. at the time, living out in L.A. And I took a walk around Marine Park. And I got the call that I got it. And I was in the middle of the park screaming, like, yes, yeah. Yes.
That's a great phone call, for yeah. sure.
Had you been watching the show? Were you a fan of it?
Absolutely, religiously. I mean, I'm probably one of the biggest fans of the show still to this day.
Wow. And, so that was a big...
Do you remember your first scene?
My first scene was the scene in the Frank Vincent, Joe Maruzzo, who played Joe Peeps, and I walked into the bar... Frank shot Lorraine through the phone book. The Lorraine Caluso character. That was my first scene. And we had, I didn't even have a line in that scene, but, I was beating up her guy, and then Frank put and Frank shot her with the, through the phone book. And we shot at, on location at some bar in Queens, and, it was a mob scene outside already at that time. I'm sure, you guys have experienced that, but I was blown away. I never, experienced anything like that. There was fans, just behind the police lines watching and just going nuts for Frank and for everybody. It was definitely the most exciting work experiences I've ever had.
And Frank was a good guy. Good, a lot of laughs. He was always upbeat, a lot of laughs, right? Working with Frank.
Yeah, sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Frank was one of a kind, man. I learned a lot from him. He was quite a guy. And I had been a huge fan of Frank since, Raging Bull. Sure. I was an usher in the Kings Plaza movie theater when Raging Bull was released. So I watched, I was like mesmerized by it. And I think that's what really solidified my desire to become an actor, that movie and De Niro specifically.
Seeing that movie in the theater when it came out, that was a huge experience for me too, man. That was just like, it was like watching a movie from the 50s, and it was it was 1980, I guess, when it came out. But it was like watching an already classic movie. And it was new.
Exactly.
It was incredible. Yeah.
Just it was incredible. Great. And, Frank was a big help. Frank always likes to help. He like you said, you learned a lot from him. When I had the tiny little thing in Casino, tiny, you know, was Frank saying, throw some lines out. You know, I had met Frank in Vegas, and he helped me get my set cut. It was Frank and Joe Pesci helped me get my set cut.
Wow.
You could barely, and Frank, it was Frank. Throw some lines out. Just get involved. You know, he was, you know, just do it. Just do it. You know, Frank was Frank was a lot of fun. Frank was a knock-around guy and a good guy, you know. So working with him was great. And then you worked mostly – you worked mostly with him, right?
Yeah, all my stuff was with Frank. I mean, I was in scenes. I was in a couple of scenes with Jim, but I had no lines with him. But still, the experience of being in a scene with, you know, James Gandolfini is still something I'm, you know, really proud of and happy about.
And then Buscemi character, Tony B, kills you, right?
And then Tony B kills me.
Tony B.
Yeah, Tony B. And then, he, you know, Steve killed me again. In Boardwalk Empire, he killed me twice.
Oh, did he? Oh, all right, there you go. There's a little question. That's a trivia question.
Yeah. Well, he claims he had me killed. He didn't do it himself. I said that. Still
close enough.
Chris, let me ask you: when did you get the call that you were getting killed off? Did that come, or how'd that happen?
Yeah. Well, Terry gave me a call, and, you know, he said, look, you know, you've been great. Loved what you did. It was the last season, so I was expecting it at some point. You mean on Boardwalk or Sopranos? I'm sorry.
Sopranos.
No, I didn't get a call, I guess, from David. I just, Terry called me and let me know. Yeah, I got a call from, not from David, but from Terry. Yeah.
So whenever the phone rings, since Terry gave you that call twice, you got to be careful. Terry's calling with bad fucking news.
Oh, yeah.
Terry's like
his name on my phone.
it's Terry. I don't think I'm going to answer. It's Terry. Terry went there. All right. I'll take that later.
In his defense, he's given me some pretty good phone calls, too, at times.
Of course.
So it equals out.
Absolutely.
What was it like working on Wolf of Wall Street for Scorsese? What was your experience there like?
Again, that was another dream come true. Of course, since Raging Bull was, made me want to become an actor. You know, I remember driving to set the first day, and I couldn't believe it. I was, like, pinching myself. And it was great, you know, because my my character, that scene I had, was basically all ad lib.
He loves improvising. That's his thing. You know?
Yeah, and it was great. And I mean, I worked on that for about 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, and I was in it for, you know, 5 seconds. But it was a great experience, and of course, another, like, you know, major point of my career. You know, that I'm proud of.
Now, Terry wrote his first movie was what? Brooklyn's Finest? What's it called?
Brooklyn Rules.
Brooklyn Rules. And who plays your character? You personally grew up with Terry. And who played you in the movie?
Scott Kahn played me.
Scott Kahn played you. Okay.
Yeah.
And what was his name in the movie?
Well, Terry changed my name to Carmine. And he did for himself also, because Freddie Prinze Jr. played Terry, and he named him Michael. The only name he left, the actual name he left was our friend Bobby Canzonieri, who Jerry Ferrara played, and Terry used Bobby's actual name.
And it's a movie about, what, growing up in Brooklyn, Marine Park area,
yeah,
is that it?
Yeah, three friends growing up in Brooklyn. And, you know, there's a little mob element to it where, you know, one of them is getting a little close to that world and the other two try to pull them away from it. And I used to be around some of those types of guys. I had a friend, his father was kind of involved. So, but I never got anywhere near that, but you know, Terry just took that and just ran with it, kind of. And
you weren't in that movie. Were you in it?
No, I was, actually. I played a guy that I used to hang out with when I was younger. So I played Alec Baldwin's right-hand man in that. I was the other mobster.
Gotcha.
And we actually shot it in the places we hung out at, you know, Spumoni Gardens. You know, we used to go there all the time.
That must have been fun.
We shot a couple of scenes at Pastels, which I'm sure you've been to.
Oh, yeah. It's in the old neighborhood.
Michael, yeah.
And how was the set of Boardwalk Empire different than the set of The Sopranos? Or was it similar?
It wasn't that. It was very similar because, you know, there's a lot of the same crew. You know, the director, Alan Coulter, Tim Van Patten, you know, the directors, of course, Terry. And it was a very, you know, very professional workplace, you know, kind of atmosphere. No egos, especially, you know, with Steve. You know, Steve's the greatest guy. And just, you know, so.
No egos, Michael. I don't know if you would have fit in over there on Boardwalk Empire.
You got a bigger ego than me, believe me.
You may not have fit in on that show.
Humble working class. Joe Lunch Pal, he pretends. That's what he pretends. None of it's true. None of it's true at all. You should travel. I've traveled with Steve, you know, in hotels. He's very, you know, he's got to have a special fan, special sheets, really? Pillows, linens.
Wow.
He drives them crazy. They got, you know, they got to assign a housekeeper just to him. All his whims.
Black out the windows.
Oh, my God.
Like they did with Elvis, right? Black out the windows so we can
very
sleep.
Very similar, yeah.
Chris, your favorite actor of all the stuff you've done, who's your favorite actor to work with?
Wow. I would have to say, it's a tough one. I would have to say Steve Buscemi. I mean, that's who I had my best stuff with. Yeah, it's
He's
tough,
a great
tough
actor.
Question, though.
Steve is a great actor.
I mean, he really
actor.
Is.
Yeah.
And, you know, you're better when you're working with him. So, you know, I mean, I got so much from him in this scene. But also, I worked a lot with Bobby Cannavale, who's a great actor. And, you
awesome.
Know, I was
awesome
working with and with Frank. But, you know, I had my biggest scene in Boardwalk was with Steve. I had a couple of big scenes with Bobby also, a few big scenes. But, yeah, I would have to go with Steve for that.
You know, he always does something unexpected. Steve is, you know, he never does what you're predicting he'll do. That's the thing about Buscemi. Yeah. Like, it's always this spin and coming from a different angle than what you'd expect right. from the page or from whatever, or from what you'd expect from him. He's a very unique individual,
yeah.
you know, and
as a performer. Too.
And very generous
actor. I mean, I remember being a little nervous preparing for my scene, but as soon as I sat and we started, you know, doing it, I felt so comfortable and it all just clicked, you know, and that was thanks to Steve. And of course, Alan Coulter, who was directing, and Terry Winter, who was writing that. But, you know, you just had to say, you know, when it comes to that kind of writing, really all you have to do is say the lines, you know, I mean.
When you're working with those guys, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Somebody like Terry. At the top, that's doesn't get much better than Terry.
No, absolutely not.
No.
I mean, we're watching episode after episode of The Sopranos, and it's just incredible what he can do. And you know, it's a Terry Winter episode, right? When you're watching him, Michael.
Oh, absolutely.
And his humor, you know, his sense of humor is just fantastic. He's a very funny dude. I laugh my ass off when I talk to him. He's great.
Oh,
great,
absolutely.
Tells great stories. What's next? You got anything on the horizon?
I shot a movie about a year and a half ago. It's called Made in Chinatown. It hasn't been released yet. In fact, Vinny Pastore and Tony Darrow are in it also.
Uh-huh.
It's a comedy, like screwball kind of broad comedy. It's like a kung fu movie mixed with a mob movie. It's really out there, but that should be released soon. And there's a few things, you know, in the works that I'm up for. Hopefully, you know, those will come through. And
terrific,
man. The fight this last year was a total bust, though.
Oh, for everybody. Yeah, for everybody. But listen, man, it's great talking to you. Great seeing you. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks for doing this.
Good,
yes, thanks
luck.
For being here.
Good luck with everything coming up, huh? And
you
take
so
care
much.
Of yourself.
I just wanted. Thanks, guys. I just wanted to mention Mike Starr, who I'm very good friends with, wanted me to say hello to both of you and send his regards.
Please tell him I said hello. Hope he's well.
Okay.
You take care, man. Thank you very much, Chris.
Thanks, guys.
Appreciate it. Chris Caldovino, ladies and gentlemen. Good guy. Let's take a break and get to the episode. All right. Good talking to those guys, man. Very good.
Yeah. Listen, I have a bone to pick with you. I have an issue I got to bring up. I mean, we're friends, but...
Again?
Yeah, bone to pick's actually the wrong choice of words. But listen, I was watching one of my favorite movies of all time. I hadn't seen it in years. It's A Mad, Mad, Mad World.
Oh, I like that movie, Buddy Hackett.
Buddy Hackett and Spencer Tracy, one of my favorite actors. But there's a, you know, it's a bunch of, you know, it's kind of a treasure hunt movie and a bunch of different groups of people all trying to get this treasure. And one of the groups has the great Milton Berle. Now, I used to love this movie. Milton Berle comes up and all I can think about now is, you know, Milton Berle and his, you know, what you described as a, I forgot how you described it.
But, large penis.
You said it's, I'm picturing one of those salamis at Katz's Deli hanging in the, from the ceiling. And it ruined the movie for me. There's a scene, he's riding in the back of a convertible and he's standing up behind Ethel Merman and she's right in front of his, you know, she's facing the camera. He's right behind her. His crotch is right behind her head. And I'm just getting
horrible
thoughts. it just became very disturbing. I used to love that movie and now it's a traumatic experience.
Milton Berle
and wearing a dress and I'm picturing, you know, all this kind of strangeness and
listen,
you blew it for me, Steve. I gotta say.
I apologize for that, but I just state the facts. What I say here on this show is 1,000% truth.
So do I. You don't believe everything I say, but it's all been documented. I have the evidence.
Okay.
I can bring it.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. I've been getting, since the Milton Berle large penis situation came up, I've been getting all kinds of comments, suggestions about penises, about celebrities and their penises. Have you?
I have not, no.
I have. So
now, why you? Why are they directing it towards you?
I don't know. Maybe I brought it up. You know, I had met him. I brought it up. First of all, look, Milton Berle, let's not kid ourselves. Not the most handsome fella.
But very funny.
Very funny. He was, kind of created TV, the first big TV star, Uncle Milty. The whole country was watching him. But he slept with many, many beautiful movie stars. He was a vaudeville comic, and he looked like a grown version of Alfred E. Newman from Mad Magazine.
Yeah, but he was very talented and very rich and very famous.
So you don't think it had nothing to do with the penis?
Well, no, not necessarily.
I think it's because the word got around. The women knew that he had a big salami, and obviously he knew how to use it. Now,
how do you know he knew how to use it?
Because he kept going through all these beautiful women, hundreds of women he slept with. All right, now, people want to volunteer stuff to me.
Who wants to?
I just want
to. Who are these people?
The fans. Now, we talked about Napoleon.
We never said Napoleon's was... No.
He had a very small penis.
Well, it's small because it's been sitting in a box for 200 years. It shriveled up. I mean, you see what you look like sitting in a box for 200 years.
I don't look better without the box. I don't look better right now.
Dillinger's. Somebody has Dillinger's somewhere.
Yeah, Dillinger.
No, but where is it? That one's in formaldehyde, I think.
Oh, let me see if it says.
I think Dillinger's is in formaldehyde somewhere.
You know, Adolf Hitler, the worst person ever born, the devil himself, had a micro penis, and he had one ball, missing testicle.
How do you know? Who knew that?
Someone sent it in here. According to rumors, Hitler had a micro penis, a missing testicle.
Well, they say that because they hated him. Everybody hated him, so they make. His doctor said that?
Maybe his doctor before he died, Napoleon. Now, LBJ, London Bing Johnson, who was the president after Kennedy, he called his penis Jumbo. Jumbo. He had a name for it called Jumbo.
So he was a douchebag, basically.
Well, I think they said that he was a douchebag.
Yeah.
Now, supposedly, according to what these fan letters I've gotten. The people living with big salamis, maybe not as big as Milton Berle's, maybe some bigger. Orlando Bloom has a big one. Justin Bieber, they're saying, has a really big one. They've seen it. John Mayer, who is arguably one of the biggest douchebags ever.
Why do you say that?
Because he slept with all these girls, then he talks
so
about it.
So did Milton Berle, didn't he? He talked about it. You're not supposed
about
to talk
it on
about
the air. He said,
I met him in a guitar store once. He was a very nice guy. I liked him a lot.
Did he know who you were?
Yeah.
I met him
in Nashville, in a guitar store in Nashville. He's a very nice guy.
They say his body actually is a wonderland. You know, he's got that song. Chris Brown, John Hamm. We both know John Hamm from Mad Men. John Hamm has a big penis. Ray J.
Where are you going with this? Where are we going with this?
I'm just giving you facts.
Tell me where we're going with this.
Brandon Roth, probably the worst Superman.
I don't even know who that is. Who's Brandon Roth?
He played Superman in one of the movies. Him. Now, Ben Affleck. Ben Affleck got a big penis. He's got a bald head. He wears a toupee. I don't know if you
know
that.
Wait a second. Where do you get your information from?
Ben Affleck wears a toupee.
No, he doesn't.
Yes, he does.
He's looked like that forever. What do you mean?
That's my point. He wears a toupee. It's a wig.
He's been famous since he's a kid.
Listen to me. You believe an octopus in the sky, and I believe that he wears a wig.
Octopus in the sky.
All right. Tommy Lee, you saw the videotape.
Everybody knows about Tommy.
Liam Neeson, Janice Dickinson, the model, wrote, Liam Neeson packs the biggest penis of any man alive. And when he unzipped his pants, it was like an Evian bottle. Evian bottle of water. Jay-Z, William Dafoe, Dan Rather. Not only is he well hung, he's intelligent. All right? John Dillinger.
Dillinger's in a jar of formaldehyde.
The rumor was that it's kept at the Smithsonian.
Oh, at the Smithsonian. They examined it to see
Jimi Hendrix. I wonder if Tony Sirico.
They made
knows
a.
About it.
There was that famous plaster caster chick, groupie, who would make plaster molds of famous rock musicians. I forget her name. She has a.
Freddie Roman, very funny comedian, the head of the Friars Club, a friend of mine. He wrote at his eulogy or his final roast, he said, well, when Milton Berle dies on May 1st and May 2nd, his penis will be buried. Milton to be buried.
But what I don't get is, here's what I don't get. We all worked on the show, on The Sopranos together. I have no idea with any, Cynthia Plasticaster is her name, the famous groupie. I have no idea with any of my co-stars on The Sopranos having their, I don't care. I don't want to know. I never knew. I don't give a shit. How do all these guys know what each other, look like naked?
This is what I'm going to assume. I'm going to assume because they have big penises that they bragged about it. And they like to show it off. And Milton Berle used to take it out. He was known to take it out, show it off.
Now I never want to see Milton Berle again. Because that's disgusting.
But he used to do that. That's a fact.
Sick.
That's a fact.
And so, gross and
I guess
wrong.
If you got a big old schlong, you want the world to know you're proud of it.
No.
Et cetera.
No, you don't. I'm sorry.
I don't have that problem. I wish I did. My penis is kind of like a beer can.
Steve.
Short and stout.
Fantastic.
Short and stout.
We're all really glad to look, it's
strong. It's sturdy like a fire hydrant.
Like a fire
hydrant.
That's why. Mine's more like a penis than a fire hydrant.
Mine's like a beer can. Good old Pabst Blue Ribbon.
You know, the nominations for the potties came out today. I have them here. The potties are the awards for the podcast. They're the golden seed pod. That's what it looks like. Yeah. Talking Sopranos has made history once again. We've made history before, haven't we? Or am I just talking at it? What did we make history before? Talking Sopranos made history once again. We've been nominated. It's the first time any podcast has been nominated both for best podcast and worst podcast.
Are you joking?
Now that's, I have it right here. Best and worst. And we could possibly win both.
Why are we the worst?
I don't know.
They don't like
Andy Verderam, best producer, and in parentheses, under the circumstances. Now, I don't know why. What does that mean, Andy? I don't know what that means. Best producer under the circumstances. Steve Schirripa, best co-host. And I got nominated for best host, so we're not competing, which is good.
best co-host.
So we got four nominations.
And you didn't manipulate
five nominations, if you include worst.
All right.
I don't do these submissions. Jeff Sussman did them.
No,
he submitted all these.
You know, any publicity is good publicity.
I don't believe that.
I don't really either. I was just saying that.
So why are you saying it?
But
you don't believe that. That's absolutely not true. All publicity is good publicity.
No, I agree with you.
I mean, in this day and age, you know that it's really been proven fact.
I agree with you. But I got a beef, believe it or not.
Believe it or not.
One that I don't use. I get a lot of comments. Maybe you don't get them, but I get messages and comments, social media. So there's a guy. His name is Mike or Mike P. Okay? He said, "What's up with Steve Schirripa's hair?" So here's a gentleman watching us on YouTube, and he wants to know what's up with my hair.
What's up with it? What's he referring to?
I have no idea. I wear a headset. It gets smashed down. I'm a 63-year-old fat man.
Yeah, but you look normal.
I'm a 63-year-old fat man with graying hair, kind of normal. I don't have a team of hair and makeup people here. There's not someone in the other room that come in on breaks and do my hair and put makeup on.
But what's he referring
press
to?
Press my shirt? I have no idea. Because he's a jack-off. He's the mayor of jack-off land. I think he lives in jack-off land. And his name, he knows who he is. So look yourself in the mirror, Mike P. And don't worry about my fucking hair. I think you should then listen to the podcast instead of watch. Because obviously you're here to critique my looks, which I've never been hired for my looks. I've got a giant nose and I'm fat and I'm old. But Mike P wants the guys to pile on. What's up with his hair? Mike P, who's in the Jack Off Hall of Fame, and he lives in Jack Off Land.
Well, he's the mayor, though.
He's the mayor of Jack Off Land. He knows who he is. He comments on Sunday nights. He's a fucking Jack Off. And there you go.
So he's going to be very happy to hear this. You know, you're going to make his day. All right.
Going to make his day?
All right, now that we've cleared the air, let's get into the episode. Huh?
Probably
we'll take a break.
He lives in the basement of his mother's house. He's a fucking loser.
Like Rupert Pupkin. He lived in the basement of his mother's house.
There you go. All right. Here we go. Season 5, Episode 3. Where's Johnny? It aired March 21st, 2004. Like 17 years ago, man, you know.
It's pretty wild, right? Where's Johnny? Actually, you know, like Here's Johnny was the famous introduction to the Tonight Show that Ed McMahon would do for Johnny Carson. Only episode that Edie Falco did not appear in.
Nor does Lorraine Bracco.
Jamie Lynn was not in this one either. But the only one Edie wasn't in. We have a new Barbara, Tony Soprano's sister, Danielle DiVecchio. This is her first episode taking over the role of Barbara. It was written by Michael Callio. Only episode he wrote. He also went on to write for Rescue Me. And I think he was the main writer, showrunner of Ironside on television. It was directed by John Patterson, the 11th of the 13 that he wrote.
Let's get into it. We start out at the bada bing at the bar. Tony sits at the bar. Tony B comes in with the laundry. you know, he's asking for the dirties. It's kind of, you know, Tony, look, Tony Soprano once came out of jail after 15 years. He's guilty, and we'll find out more about that later on. But Tony Soprano was guilty that Tony B went to jail. It could have been him, or could it have been? But kind of guilty. He wants to help him.
He calls him Mr. Clean, which it refers both to the laundry and kind of not going into the family business. And Tony B doesn't like that joke. You know, he's busting his ass. It's not easy work. And he don't like, you see, he resents it.
Well, as he should. He's trying to go straight. He doesn't want to go back to jail. Next time, you know, you do 15 years, you come out, you do something bad, you that's it.
You're done.
Rap, it's a wrap. You're done, you know. You know, he says, you know, come on. It could have just as easily been me that went away. It's the luck of the draw. Come on. I was going to be there the night of the hijacking. Well, it ain't like you came away unscathed. No, a couple of goons jumped me, cut my head open. Had 16 stitches. You got 15 years. We come to find out the real story later on. Tony B says, you're always a lucky fuck. And he goes, it's not completely true. I got a lot of sorrows. All his sorrows in his life were brought on basically by himself.
By himself. And he's, like you said, he is feeling guilty. Tony B brings up Feech, which Tony Soprano, you know, take that in. He doesn't like that.
Well, he saw in the last episode, he saw Feech giving him a boost. Right. Gave him an envelope. Remember when he came out?
That's
Tony
right.
watched that and didn't like that. Feature's car, they're driving. He treated Tony B to lunch. He says, I'm serious about this massage therapy. Well, you should keep a square job for appearances. Look at me at the bakery. Feature's now running a bakery. He says, look, I told my cousin I want to stay a civilian. The boy king. He says, can I be honest with you for a second about your cousin? We never hear what he's got to say, but we know Feech doesn't like it.
Feech was probably going to say something against Tony, and Tony B was kind of receptive, or he would have listened. He would have heard him out, I think.
And Feech did 20 years. 20 years. It's a long time, you know. So he comes out.
Yeah, he went away as a, you know, in his prime, basically, you know. Probably was making a lot of money, had a lot of power. And wants it back, you know, because he feels he took the hit for the family.
Yeah. He knew he didn't snitch. He didn't turn, you know. And you would think that there would be a nice something waiting for him when he came out. And he didn't roll over, which he could have. But that's not the case. And there's a lot of that.
That's not, you know, there's always a lot of that. Yeah. Why is that?
There's always a lot of that in the mob where they go, don't worry. We're family for life. You go away, your family, your kids, they'll all be taken care of. Bullshit. You hear it has it ever happened? I'm sure, but time and time again, you hear that it never happens.
Short
memories.
They go
away. And in Goodfellas, you saw that. You know, they didn't take care of, Henry Hill's character and his wife and the kids and, you know, all of that stuff. Very short memories. And he sees the landscapers.
Sal Vitro.
He stops the car, played by Louis Mastillo, who's going to be a guest on our show soon.
And you just worked with him, didn't you?
Just worked with him on Blue Bloods. Terrific actor, terrific guy. It was a series regular on Mike and Molly. Real character actors, done a ton of stuff. And he's really good in this. He pulls him over. Hey, my nephew does the lords of this neighborhood. Since I've been working this neighborhood 26 years, he grabs him, he kicks him in the balls, he knocks him down. Then he puts his hand over the curb and smashes it
breaks
down.
Breaks his wrist. Yeah, really. Brutal. Oof. And I got to say, Robert Loggia really pulls this off. He's scary, he's rough, he's tough. You believe that he doesn't give a fuck and he has no qualms about doing this. Yeah.
And he doesn't give a fuck. Junior's house. Tommy turns on the TV.
Tommy's played by Ed Satrakian, who's a guy. He's 92 now, but he's been in a lot of stuff over the years. 3 Days of the Condor, Pope of Greenwich Village. I worked with him on a stage reading of a play called Blue Moon that we did in a few different venues that Lee Grant directed. Thomas G. Waits wrote. And Ed's a really good actor, and it was great to see him in this role again. He's playing Tommy.
You know, you can see the junior's dementia is setting in. He's watching Curb Your Enthusiasm.
He got cable finally. That was
a
new
cable.
And which he didn't have for a long time, right? He never had up till recently.
Had cable. He's looking. He's mistaken Bobby for Jeff Garlin.
This is one of the funniest moments. When I saw this for the first time, I screamed. it's really funny. And the way that Larry David's looking into the camera, and Junior's just convinced it's him and Bobby, and it has something to do with the trial, because he saw himself on TV when he was the artist rendering of him at the trial, and it's very funny.
Dementia setting in as he's changing the channels. There's a guy, the decorator. I don't know what happened to him. Chris Lowe, I think his name is. He was early decorating TV guy.
Was that this old house? Was that what it was called?
No, that's Bob Villa. That's Bob Villa. That's also mentioned in this.
That's later on.
Yeah. But I think his name is Chris Lowe. And I don't know, the guy disappeared for some reason, but he was one of the pioneers in the home decorating stuff. Dementia setting in. We see Junior's very confused. Bada ring back room. Tony's at the desk. Bobby arrives. Bobby is asking for a promotion. He says,
the promotion, right? But now you just want to be earning.
He's not earning. He's earning. He's still watching Junior. He's asking. Tony's not stupid. You know, Janice is pulling the strings behind this. Bobby comes in. He says, I waited 45 minutes for stool softener. It's humiliating. Come on. Just give me a chance to earn. That's all I'm asking. Tony asks, how's my sister doing? The Epstein bar. I don't know.
People say that all the time.
Is Epstein bar even a real thing?
Much about it. I mean, but Janice is not a real thing. Janice has, we know Janice makes stuff up and she just manipulates people. You know, I think Tony Soprano deals with this all the fucking time. Everybody wants more. Nobody's ever getting their just desserts. Everybody wants a bump up. Everybody wants to earn more. And he's always trying to figure out ways of,
But isn't that what being the boss is? If you were a showrunner, listen, if you're running a big company, people come up to you constantly. I want a promotion. I earn a promotion. I deserve a promotion. I want a raise. If it's a TV show, I want more lines. I want my character to do this or that. I mean, that's it, man,
Yeah.
That's how it goes.
Was it like that in Vegas when you were running the entertainment department at the Riv?
Yeah, I want this. Can I get that? I think I deserve it. Hey. Sometimes they're right. They're not always wrong. Sometimes people get overlooked for one reason or another. Maybe you got to go, you know what? This guy's right. He has been loyal to me. He has been good to me. He's done a lot of stuff for me. You know, maybe he does deserve a raise or a chance to earn more money, right?
Sure.
I mean, sometimes you get overshadowed for one reason or another, Bobby's kind of low key. He's not like Paulie. Paulie's front and center. Ralphie was front and center. Sometimes you get lost in the shuffle, right?
Right.
Quiet guy. Aunt Mary's house. Oh, I love Aunt Mary.
Anna
Very
Maria
real.
Gottfried plays
Very
the role
real.
Of Aunt Mary. She's and really did, good. She's excellent.
Really good.
Yeah, very believable.
Very real. What's going on? Nobody's cutting the lawn. Paulie wants to know. I got to tell you, Paulie, a murderer, a killer. First of all, his mother's a pain in the ass.
Nucci.
A pain in the ass. A whiner. And he's holding her pocketbook. He's carrying her pocketbook. Now, listen. One thing that I don't do, I don't ever carry my wife's pocketbook. Just not my thing. I see guys waiting for their in the hair salon. They're waiting for their wife getting a haircut. The guy's sitting there with his wife's bag or pocketbook on his lap. Come on. Come on now. Come on. Do you do that? Do you carry your wife's pocketbook around?
I can't recall doing it recently or ever. but I mean, if it was she needed help, I would
well,
do it.
Well, if she said, hold this for a second while I get in the car, that's different. Yeah. Paulie's walking in the mother's purse.
He's a good son. He loves his mother.
They're trying to make it like Green Grove is paradise. They're lying. We know what goes on in Green Grove.
They're lying.
Aunt Mary, they're trying to say, Mary, you got to see this. Oh, she's a belle of the ball over there. No, she's not.
No, she's not.
They don't like her there.
She's scorned.
She's a snitch.
Yeah.
That's all I can tell you. You know, some men in a Cadillac, you know, she tells him somebody beat up Salvicio after all these years, broke his arm. What's his name, Aunt Mary? And she got the card.
Well, what's funny, it says E, the initial, E period Gary LaManna. Another great Soprano detail. In any other show, it would just be Gary LaManna. But here it's E period Gary LaManna, which is a very specific, tiny detail. But
why do you think that is? It could be also they couldn't get it approved. You know,
it's very distinctive. I think it's very funny. It's a tiny detail, but it's great.
Aunt Mary's very good. We're in a bar in Manhattan.
The bar, the exterior is a shot at Greenwich Village, Greenwich Avenue, right? In Greenwich Village, the actual interior was shot at Fiddler's Green in Flushing, which I think does not exist anymore. Fiddler's Green Bar in Flushing.
We have a Lorraine. We saw her before. Patty Darbinville.
Lorraine Caluzzo and Jason Evanina, who's her, I guess, her boyfriend and her muscle at the same time.
Yeah. It's very funny. She comes in shaking the guy down, the bartender. He gives half, then he gives the other half. She gets really nasty with him. You could see how nasty she could be. What's funny is the door opens and here comes Frank Vincent is great in this scene.
Yeah.
And he's carrying a phone book. It's not like he found the phone book, which don't even exist anymore, but he found the phone book and, you know, it was like a spur of the moment. He walks in with the phone book.
I have this in my notes. I wanted to bring it up. What was his intention? Was his intention to, he knew if he shoots that this phone book is going to prevent the bullet from going through. He knew.
Yeah, I'm sure he knew.
This was never meant to be a murder.
No, I'm sure he knew that. I'm sure they've tried that. They've done it before.
They've done ballistic tests at, you know.
maybe, but he walks in with the phone book.
Which is hilarious.
And of course, you know,
he's
threatening her. He tells her, you know, she says, I'll suck your cock. I'll suck all your cocks. And he asks her boyfriend, he's got his foot on his head. Is she any good? He said, what am I asking you for? You probably taught her how.
Right.
Frank Vincent is just great here. It's very funny. He's completely in command. Now, am I wrong? But I thought when he shoots her, you see that she pissed on the floor. I didn't see it in this scene, but I saw that somewhere.
Oh, I didn't see it. I don't remember.
I
do not remember.
I don't know if I saw that. She was so scared. You're kicking up. You should be kicking up to Johnny Sack. You're kicking up to Little Carmine. It won't happen again. We told you. He shoots through the, which got to be scary as hell, shoots through the phone book. And he only makes it to the R's.
And he
close.
Knew this. So he planned this out. This is a big warning to scare her rather than kill her.
He had his brother there, you know, Billy Leotardo.
And Joe Peeps, played by Joe Maruzzo.
And played by Chris Caldovino, who we just spoke to. He plays Billy, Phil's brother. It's a really, really good scene. It makes it very clear what's what. Frank Vincent is at his best.
Yeah, he's really good in that scene. He was excellent.
Melvoin's office. Tony and Junior meet with Angelo, Lorraine, and Jason.
Yeah, I love Junior's line, I have cable.
Yeah, yeah.
Something he's very proud of now.
Very proud. I got cable. Tony, you know, Junior brings up the makings of the varsity athlete right in the middle of this very important meeting. Tony gets annoyed, but he lets it go. Angelo's going on and on about his grandkids, how much he enjoys, you know what I find weird? Tony getting into their business. I find it very weird. He's the boss of the New Jersey, a small family. He's getting into the business about who's going to have the power in this family. I find it kind of odd, don't you?
Well, I mean, listen, it's been set up on the show for that because he is working close with Johnny Sack and Johnny, you know, and he reached out to Little Carmine. So he is kind of in the mix there. They bring up the idea instead of one or the other doing a power sharing thing, kind of like what they have in New Jersey. And Junior says that's not all it's cracked up to be, which is hilarious. And Dominic, this is the beginning really of his playing this dimension stuff, and he is just throughout this episode fantastic. I mean, nails it every scene, every line.
Just so good, so good. Yeah. What I was thinking was maybe three bosses, like Caesar. Little Carmine, Johnny, and you think about it. There's no way when I heard this that Johnny Sack's going to go for this.
No.
Johnny Sack assumes he's the man.
And Angelo doesn't want it. He doesn't want any part of it. No. He wants to kind of lay low. He wants to make some money, but just kind of...
He's been away a long time, you know. He's enjoying living with the grandkid and his daughter.
And he's older. You know. Does he want all those headaches all the time? No.
In theory, Paulie meets with Sal.
Salvatore, my dolly, he says.
He says they released these fucks from the can. Obviously, he wasn't rehabilitated.
Right.
Talking about Feech. Sal's going, my wife, she's got me thinking about going to the cops. Hey, where are you from? You know, let me talk to the guy for you. I just want a couple of percent. Always about the money. We've talked about this over and over. He is going to help Sal for a few percent. He sees an opportunity, Paulie, to make some money off this landscaping thing.
Not just get involved for his aunt, but now to get a couple percent. Does he literally mean 2%? 2 points on what he makes?
Maybe 5%. I don't know. What do you get? I don't know what the price is. I pay my landscaper. I don't have that big a lawn anymore, but it's like $80 a month. Comes once a week. The guy in Vegas, I had a much bigger loan. I paid him $260 a month.
So figure 5% of that is what? $260, $13 a month times how many clients he has. You know, it's a couple hundred dollars, maybe.
I mean, really, it's really small.
Paulie's really kind of small change. And if you see
small
how
potato.
Is, you know, he's kind of a scrounger in a way, right? He's kind of a small-time Charlie Hustle. You know what I mean? He's grabbing whatever he can.
He gives the bartender, I don't know, maybe a $20 bill. He says, this one and the next one.
And the next one, like it's his grand gesture. Then he takes the lawnmower, you know, like little, you know, he's just...
I mean, like I said, even if it was $300 a month and you're taking 5%, so what's that, $15?
$15
a month, but he's got a big route. So, how much? How much could Sal Vicho be making a year? Let's put it that way. Let's say he making. I'm gonna go high. $100,000 a year.
$100,000. Then he's getting what? $5,000.
I guess.
A year.
Look at it. Pays for something. You know.
It all adds up. Put it in the kitty.
Feech's bakery, the back room. Paulie meets with Feech. Hey, how you doing? Calls him the king of the breadsticks or something. He doesn't like that right off the bat, Feech. I'll give you your breadsticks, you know. He tells him, you know, hey, I got a guy. I think you may have run into him. Gone, the name is Salvicho. Says your nephew's moving into the neighborhood. I want to put a good word in for the kid. Do me a favor. You and your nephew lay off. Feech ain't having it.
Not at all.
He ain't having it. You know, he says, what about Jerry, the fruit who owns those hair salons? He came to me the other day. He asked me to take his action on the Knicks. Jerry's my customer for years now. What's yours is yours, Paulie, but what ain't is anybody else's. Now get the, and he screams at him.
He screams, get the fuck out of my store.
You don't see many people do that to Paulie.
No. And Paulie Feach doesn't give a shit. Yeah, Feach does not give a shit about it.
Paulie slinks away. He came out ripping and tearing. But Paulie got a great line. Where I come from, you get points for staying out of the can.
Right.
Because he wants points. He went into the can. He figures, you know, I'm old, blah, blah, blah. And Paulie's going, you get points for staying out of the can.
Yeah.
Tony's truck. Tony drives Janice and AJ. Bobby came to see me. She dummies up. And he knows. We discuss his career. I'm his wife. He needs a little push.
Well, what's Bobby weird here is, you know, he says Bobby's took his son to the 12 o'clock mass. Tony's like, really? I didn't know Bobby was religious. And she says at this point he'll try anything. So all her religious stuff, now there's no religious stuff. She's kind of looking down on you for going to church.
She's crazy.
She's very judgmental. She's really.
We've said it. She's the fucking devil. Much worse than Olivia ever
she's
was.
Worse. She's worse than Tony in some ways, huh?
I mean, come on. She's a murderer. She does the shit with Ralphie. She's a murderer. She's crazy. You know, crazy. Yeah. Well, worse than Tony. I always thought somehow, I didn't know the ending until the very end. I thought somehow that she would possibly kill Tony Soprano and take over. Or how would Bobby take over? I always thought that was a possibility, you know?
I could see that.
I kind of always thought that was maybe going to happen. She's complaining about how much she does. She cooks, she cleans, she takes care of the two kids. You know, Tony says Sunday dinners are important. The family stuff, these Sunday dinners, they're important, Janice. Right.
And Janice, you know, is catering it. So instead of...
Yeah, yeah.
She wants all the trappings, but she doesn't want to do any of the work. She wants to be like this, you know, generous person and then cooking for everyone and inviting, but she don't want to do the work. She's always
She doesn't want it. She's got a ready-made family. You think she's ready to have two kids? I mean, she smokes weed. She does coke. She's a murderer. Let's go on and on and on. Now she's got a kid that's like 10 and 11 year old. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
They're not easy. I mean, Bobby Jr.'s a handful. He wets the bed, she says. You know, Bobby Jr. doesn't like her. It's very obvious in this episode. You know?
Oh, no. Both of them don't like her. And Vesuvio, I don't see why they should.
Yeah. Vesuvio, Janice, and Tony arrive. Charmaine brings out the food. Tony goes into the kitchen. She's getting it all catered. Janice. So what's the big deal? Tony's paying for it.
Right.
I mean, you know, she's getting, you know, she's talking about Livia and herself. Suddenly she's got compassion for Livia.
Right. Tony says she chose to be that way, and Janice says she didn't choose. That's the way she was. She suffered because she was so miserable, and Tony's not having that.
An ungrateful husband, selfish kid. She's comparing her to Livia.
Right.
There's trouble in Bacala land. It's pretty obvious there. Tony goes in the back. Hey, Artie, you know, I know you got to move. Why don't you bunk with me for a while? So they kind of patch it up. But Tony always an ulterior motive. He's got a scheme where he could save Artie 70%.
He also, you know, if you think about it, he also knows if Artie's living with him, he's going to eat a lot. He's going to eat well.
I guess.
Because Artie's bringing home food every night. Artie's living in a Motel 6. He's having a rough time, Artie. His aunt, he was living with his aunt. He was living in his aunt's house. She took the house back, and now he's in a Motel 6.
Junior's house. Bobby and Junior watching TV. Janice is in the kitchen.
Junior wants to eat. He's impatient. You know, and this is a real thing, because I remember we always had Sunday dinner around 2 o'clock. And my grandfather, in my grandmother's house, you know, my grandfather was he didn't like waiting after 2 o'clock. Like 2 o'clock was 2 o'clock, and it was time to eat. You know.
Yeah.
Well, people Junior, were late. He hated it.
He comes in. She said, "We could have the macaroni. Have the macaroni now." Blah blah blah. They sit down. Junior gives him the first jab. They're waiting on the rest of the family, on Barbara and her family. Barbara's bringing veal pizzaiole and chicken palm, so she got her to do work. Janice basically is just taking it out of the containers,
yeah,
and putting it in the dishes.
Yeah,
that's all she's doing.
She's farming it all out to everybody else. Exactly. Tony's going to pay for the catering. Barbara's going to bring, and she doesn't really have to do anything.
You know, Bobby has, Bobby's got, he doesn't understand these. They're watching Bob Villa. He doesn't like the old houses. The three of them, these three mob guys, are just watching this on a Sunday afternoon, watching a reality show.
But that's what you do on Sunday afternoon. You're gonna have Sunday dinner. You watch. If there's not a game on, if it's not a movie, it'll be something like that. It's
So Junior gives him the first jab about having, about the makings of a varsity athlete, which has become one of the famous lines that people repeat over and over. You never had the makings of a varsity athlete. Bobby asks AJ about football, about one of the teams. And then once again, Junior brings it up and Tony just goes off.
Well, Tony doesn't know that he's having any kind of dementia issue, so he just thinks Junior's pushing his buttons, and he's sick of it, and he feels it's hurtful and undermining, and it's something that, it's obviously some kind of...
Sore spot,
yeah.
He says, what's the hell's with you? It's not true. I led it in football. He said, you never played in college. Who's talking about college? Those guys were 7 feet tall. So, and then here comes Barbara and her family, right in the middle of the argument.
They don't know what's going on. Yeah.
They don't know what's going on. They came all the way
Brewster.
Westchester.
Brewster, where I actually went to high school. I lived there for a while when I was
So that's a long way to Jersey, ain't it?
Brewster's is Putnam County, New York. So it's an hour north of the city. So you got to come south and then get on, cross the Tappan Zee into Rockland County, New York, then go down into Jersey. It's a hike, yeah.
So it's an hour and a half.
Depending on traffic. Yeah, it's a waste.
And he said, let's go. But, there's a... Tony says, we're leaving. End of subject. Now, one of Jim's movies that he loved, Avalon. You ever see the movie Avalon? Barry Levinson movie?
No. What is
about
it?
It's such a good movie, Michael. He did Diner, which took place in Baltimore.
I've seen
and
that.
And Avalon is, it took place in Baltimore. And it's kind of an extension, him growing up and his family. It's really, really, a really nice movie. And there's a big scene in that Aidan Quinn is in it, Kevin Pollak, a bunch of great actors. And they cut the turkey. They were waiting for Thanksgiving. And his brother was late. And they cut the turkey, and that was it. They didn't talk for 20 years. You cut the turkey. You couldn't wait for me. You cut the turkey. Jim would always say that. And this is kind of what he did there. End of subject. We're leaving. And he kind of did a version of, you cut the turkey.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, you cut the turkey. You cut the turkey. That was a catastrophe before we get here.
Disrespect.
On Thanksgiving. Yeah, but also, he's always late. He's always late. The hell with it. And that's when Jim said, get your coat on. AJ says, I don't have a coat. We're leaving. I caught that.
That's pretty cool. I like that.
We're back
detail.
At Aunt Mary's house. Paulie sees Vitro landscaping outside.
Vitro had to fire his helper and take his kid out of college because he's struggling. He can't afford his son's tuition. The son's got to work for him. It's bad.
Paulie takes care of the old ladies. He's there. He likes to take care of them, And Sal gives Paulie a look in the window like, you let me down. Because he said he was going to take care of it, Paulie. He didn't take care of it.
He did not.
We're in the Shea Stadium parking lot.
Did you go to Shea Stadium a lot? Have you been?
I was younger, I was a Met fan when I was younger.
You were?
Then
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, when I was younger. Yeah, then I became a Yankee. As a matter of fact, I became a Yankee fan kind of when I moved back to New York.
So you were a Met fan.
Until like 99.
I used to go, I was always a Yankee fan, but my grandfather used to get box seats from somebody you work for. One time he took me and I met Joe Louis, the boxer. who's sitting right next to us at Shea Stadium. I was there for the wrestling match. I told you, Andre the Giant. That was pretty exciting. And I was at Shea Stadium for the Mets-Yankees World Series in 2000.
Oh, wow.
HBO called me and last minute said they had two tickets. So I grabbed my neighbor across the street and we went out to Shea. And I thought it was HBO's box. It was right near the press box. And we're sitting there and all these cops come in. I'm like, what the hell's going on? And then Giuliani, who was mayor at the time, walked in. It was his box. He gave HBO the tickets and said, send some of the Sopranos if they want, because he was a big Soprano
fan. Yeah, he liked the Sopranos. It's kind of went before he went off the deep end.
He went off the deep end, yeah. So we watched the game with Rudy Giuliani, the Mets.
Good.
The Yankees won that time. There were more Yankee fans in Shea Stadium than there were Met fans, and it was the Met Stadium. I'll be honest with you.
When I was 9 years old, Little League, I played for St. Francis Cabrini. We had our dinner, you know, like a breakfast, you know, where they gave out the trophies, at Fuffy's Pancake House. Fuffy's Pancake House, corner of 86th Street and 16th Avenue. It was a breakfast. And Bud Harrelson and Tom Seaver, it was their rookie year, they showed up. I still have Bud Harrelson's autograph. I don't know what happened to Seaver's, but I was 9 years old, and they came. I mean, I don't know what they paid them back then, but they came. It was a Sunday morning, and they came out. And
where was that, in Bensonhurst?
In Bensonhurst. Yeah. 16th, after that, it became Umberto's Clam House, but it was Fuffy's Pancake House, and the two of them showed up. Imagine, you know, they showed up back then. They did whatever they could to make some extra money, so I'm sure they got paid.
A lot of them didn't make the big bucks back then.
Yeah. They were rookies, 1967. Tony meets with Johnny Sack. Tony's explaining him. Angelo Gareppi came to see me. Lorraine Coluzzo reached out. I got to nip this little Carmine shit in the butt. Otherwise, I got to see a lot of people start fucking around. Nobody's sure who to pay, so nobody gets paid. In large measure, I blame you for this shit with Little Carmine. You legitimized him by going down there to see him.
This is a big thing. And you see Johnny Sack, number one, of course, he wants to be boss, but he also realizes that power vacuum, nobody's going to kick up because they're not sure who to kick, who's in charge. The captains kind of keep the money that's going up the ladder, and he's worried about money. Tony blames the idea on Angelo. It was Angelo's idea to do this triumvirate, however you say that. Johnny Sack doesn't like that.
No, he calls it the UN.
It's a great line. Also revealed in this scene is that Tony had a thing with Lorraine Coluzzo one time.
Yeah, he says, you fucked her, right? And he goes, well, it's nothing secret, a long time ago.
And everybody knows everything, huh?
I got a Bill Sheft, who used to write the monologue for David Letterman, comic, stand-up comic, and a great writer, Bill Sheft. He had a great joke about Shea Stadium. He said, I took my girlfriend to a very fancy meal the other night. You may have heard of the place, Shea Stadium. I thought it was funny. That's
Shea
a good
Stadium.
Joke.
Yeah, that's a good joke.
Get it?
Shea, like Shea Black or Shea
C-A-G-Z.
Right.
Come on, man. Come on.
No, I get it.
You like those highbrow jokes.
No, I don't like... I'm actually quite lowbrow when it comes to humor, but that's not low enough, actually.
Shea Stadium. Junior's house. Bobby arrives. Tommy's watching Anthony Robbins. Now, Tony Robbins. Is this guy... What's he, a motivational guy? Is he a bullshitter? Is he a... What is this guy?
I guess he's a motivational, like a life coach. I think they said Trump worked with him, Clinton, the Kardashians, Oprah, Pitbull. I don't know. I don't go in for that kind of self-help pop psychology shit, to be honest. That's not my thing. I don't know. I mean, some people... You know, like that stuff. I guess he kind of basically, you know what these people do? They give you confidence. They teach you to have confidence in yourself, or they pump you up so you have confidence to go out and do what you want to do. Basically, that's what it is, I think.
I think I could be a good life coach.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
You mean pump up people's confidence?
Motivate them. Motivate them. No?
I think so. I think you're right. Were you ever a coach? Like a sports coach?
I was a basketball coach, yeah. Baseball and basketball.
Well, that's a lot of that. I did. I was a baseball coach a couple of times. Yeah, that's about pumping up confidence, right?
But this guy's got a whole conglomerate. He's got people. They pay a lot of money.
He's got a $1 billion empire, yeah.
You know, he's got all kinds of money. He's been in movies. He was in Shallow Hal. He had a big role.
It ain't my bag, man. It's not my bag.
You know. I notice a lot of people, their life coach, they just made themselves a life coach. Like one day they decided, I'm going to put a shingle out. I don't know. Do you need a license for that?
I mean, I don't know. Maybe he has some kind of psychology degree. I really don't know. I don't know much about him. I don't really want to know.
We know Dr. Phil's a bullshit artist. He kind of is in the same realm of that.
He's a doctor of
nuts. Doctor of bullshit.
No, but he's a doctor of, we heard that before. He's not a
doctor of philosophy.
Yeah.
Doctor of philosophy. Bobby is sweating. He's nervous. Comes upstairs.
Tommy says he's taking a nap.
His car is gone.
He's not taking a nap.
You know, with his bail, he's not allowed to leave the house. Where is he? Bobby is in automatic panic mode for a few reasons. One, he loves Junior like a father. Two, he's going to hear it from Tony.
It's kind of his responsibility.
This is his job. You know, Tommy is not the brightest bulb. Next thing we know, we see Church of Ministry. Junior's walking the streets. Now, are they in Belleville or Newark?
It's actually Irvington, right near Newark. Yeah, it's close to Newark. And they go into church. That's George T. Odom, a really good actor. He was in that movie, that indie Straight Out of Brooklyn. He also was in Malcolm X and a lot of other films. Good guy and a really good actor. I know I've met George and worked with him, actually. He's really good.
He says, I want to see Johnny Soprano. You know, they're talking to the kids. He's giving a lecture to the kids. I guess, I don't know, the kids out selling candy. To raise money,
it seems like it's a church group that raising money for charity. And an older guy remembers that place was once owned by, you know, the Italians and Johnny Soprano. There were vending machines, whatever they did. This is going back 40 years, right? We're talking probably.
I don't know if it's that long, but it's a long time. And they rough him up a little. They throw him out. They push him out on the sidewalk. They rough Junior up a little bit. He's walking around. I don't know if he has slippers on.
He's got slippers on and a bathrobe. Yeah.
I mean, you know, he's an old white man in this neighborhood, and could be 40 years. Junior's house, Tommy, now I think about it, Junior was acting a little peculiar when I got here today. Said he wanted to see Johnny. What, Johnny, his brother, Bobby? No. Also, the other day, watching a program. I mean, suddenly, Tommy's thinking about this now.
Yeah, they also called Roberta, Bobby Sanfilippo, the girlfriend that Junior used to go out with, who hit her in the face with a pot.
Bobby's sweating, Bobby's nervous, Bobby's panicking. Janice is watching the Home Shopping Network. Joy Mangano. Did you see that movie, Joy?
No.
It's a great movie.
Yeah.
Really good movie about real woman, Joy Mangano, who, started all the products. And
home shopping thing.
She was broke. And, you know, I went on QVC.
To sell the sauce?
To sell the sauce. And we sold 85,000 worth of sauce. It wasn't enough for them. They never had me back.
Really?
We went out of business, obviously, but... I had to go down there. They have a whole complex. It's amazing.
Where?
You could take, in Pennsylvania, you could take tours, but I had to go down there and take lessons, courses about their way of selling. And even no matter how much you're on TV, not on TV, it meant nothing. So there was, you know, a bunch of us.
Well, what do they want you to do specifically?
you don't say this and you don't say that and you don't guarantee. There's words you can't use, can't say healthy and can't do this. So you had everyone selling their products and you give samples and, you know, you do it. And she gives you notes. You got to do it in front of the other people. And, you know, it's very intricate. Listen, they know what they want. They know what they don't want. Because at first you're going, look, I know. You know, blah, blah, blah. You don't know.
And, the exact opposite of the podcast.
Exactly. This is, they know exactly what's going on. We know nothing. We just fucking wing it. But I was there. It was a all day, 8 hour course. 8 hours.
8 hours? Are you kidding me? Eight hour course of how to sell on QVC?
Correct. You break for lunch.
And you're rehearsing? You're rehearsing the pitch and all that?
Rehearsing. They're giving you notes.
Holy shit.
You sit with them privately and back. Yeah, I'm telling you. Very heavy duty. And then the day of, you know, when you got your slot, had to go back down there, got your slot. There's a guy, he talks to you for 5 minutes. The guy's great. I forget the guy's name. He's and he's there on Wednesdays. He's the master. This guy's the master. He's been there from the beginning in the kitchen. Dave, I think. Dave, great. Goes over things for 5 minutes. You get out there with him. He asks you certain questions. There's a certain way, certain rhythm of doing things. Quite amazing. Janice is watching Home Shopping Network.
And the first thing she says is, did you drop off the dry cleaning? Like, she's just with an attitude, too. Like, kind of nasty.
She's sitting there. Bobby is upset. He's asking her, you got to come over here. I got to go out looking for him. As she's talking to Bobby, Bobby Jr. is mixing, cocoa in his
chocolate milk. Yeah.
And she dumps it out. She dumps it out. She doesn't want him to drink the chocolate milk. My grandfather did this. I'm afraid he might have wandered. I need you to come here just in case he comes back. Bobby, I can't. He says, Jesus Christ, sometimes I think I love Junior more than you do, Janice.
I think that's true. He yells at her. Yeah.
He yells at her. She's a selfish, like Tony, selfish, selfish, selfish. Paulie's car. Paulie's listening to The Art of War by Sun Tzu.
Sun Tzu. He will win who knows when to fight and when not to fight. That's the clip we hear while he's driving, and this is exactly what he's going into. Jimmy LaManna is on the ground. That's Anthony DeCio. And up in the tree is E. Gary LaManna, played by Michael Cavalieri, who's a friend of mine. I worked with him on a Walter Hill movie called Last Man Standing. He was also in The Karate Kid. Martial arts expert, was a champion, yeah? Champion martial artist, and a good guy. He's up in the tree. He and they are both, I believe, both nephews of Feech, right?
Feech, and he comes over. This is one of the, it's violent, but it's very funny. He comes over, they're nasty to him. They don't know who they're fucking with. Because they got Feech behind them, and they're both very nasty. They tell him to take a fucking hike, eat shit. And he goes, yeah. And Paulie, no bones about it. This is what we've talked about. These guys could joke and laugh and have all these quirks. When it comes to business, do not fuck with these guys. He picks up the shovel and bangs them right off the back of the head with it. Like... like nothing, not even think twice. No. Could have killed him, obviously.
Could have killed him. And then the guy, he loses, lets go of the rope, and the guy in the tree falls down. It was a bit like a cartoon. Comic. It kind of was hilarious.
A big fall, he comes down. He takes his wallet, takes the money, all about money, tells him he's going to owe him $1,200 for hospital bills, takes money out of his wallet. The guy gets nasty. He says, I'll give you a crack. Paulie lets him go. Then he grabs the lawnmower. And if you see, that's a stunt double with the lawnmower. And he's got Tony Sirico and Paulie's walk down. It's a stunt double for sure.
Really?
And he picks up that lawnmower, puts it in the trunk. Take another look at that.
Oh, yeah, I got to see
that. That's not Tony.
That's pretty
and
funny.
And he wheels the lawnmower away and he picks it up. And it's very funny. And he walks away with it. That is a funny, funny scene.
It is funny.
They fuck with the wrong guy. Christopher is there. Bobby calls Tony's house.
Chris is waiting outside in the car. And he tells him specifically, they're going to see Johnny Sack. And he just says, listen, when that Johnny Sack and Little Carmine stuff comes up, you clam up. Specifically says it to Christopher. And he's like, of course.
Do not say anything.
Yeah.
Bobby says he's gone. He's gone. Listen, your uncle. It's your uncle. He's gone. You mean he's dead? No. He said he was going to see Johnny. You think he might have met your dad? He's wandering, Tone. He could wander off the Palisades for all I care. He's fucking dead to me. This is about the varsity athlete line.
All right. And then some time passes. Janice shows up at Junior's house. Bobby's waiting. He's like, where you been? She had to pick up the kids. And
she took her time.
He says, you got to wait by the phone. She's like, he gets a day off and I got to wait by the phone. She just doesn't give a shit. And the kids, which is funny, when Bobby Jr. says, can Janice go and we stay here? They don't want to be around Janice.
They don't want to be him. He tells the kid, he tells his son, lay off the Snapple.
Right.
Because he pees a lot. I like Snapple. Do you drink Snapple?
No.
Why?
I just don't. I don't know.
It says it's made from the greatest stuff on earth, Snapple. I drink a lot of Snapple. I like it.
What do you drink?
Diet lemon, diet peach.
Really?
You know, it's good.
I got this. I got my. This is called Daily Green from Juicy Lucy over on Avenue A. Juicy Lucy's
looks terrible.
Great. Kale, spinach, celery, and cucumber with a kiss of ginger.
Do you walk around? Do you wear a diaper all day? Do you
for
need
what?
A diaper?
What?
Taking a dump? That make you take a dump?
That's not why I drink it. No.
Are you taking a dump right?
I drink it for the nutrients. Right, they also make cafe con leche, made from cafe Bustelo. Fantastic.
And this doesn't make you go to the bathroom?
No. It gives me energy. So I can spar with you on the air and be on my game. Because if I lose a step, you're going to be all over me. You're going to wipe the floor with me.
Sometimes when we're on the phone together, I hear you go, yeah, we're talking a conversation. And you go, oh.
No,
sometimes
you don't.
I think you're taking a dump while we're talking.
You've never heard that ever.
Listen, John Patterson, who we've talked about, they kept spraying me down. Not that they have to, because I'm usually sweating anyway, but they were spraying me down because I was wet and panicking. And John Patterson would send this by now. He was sick. So he would send the AD over. And he would say, John said to bring that down 33.3%.
Yeah, he used to say stuff like that.
John said, bring it up, bring the energy up 5%.
Yeah.
You know, it makes you laugh. It makes you relax as opposed to giving you those notes. You know, I got a kick out of that a lot.
I love the end of the scene. If anyone cares, I'll be upstairs lying down. Janice.
Yes. Lay off the Snapple.
Mulberry Street, that's Matachiaro Bar on Mulberry Street, the inside. Johnny Sack
They're
talking
eating?
About... What? They're eating, and Johnny Sack's talking about how him and Little Carmine used to be close, how he arranged Little Carmine's bachelor party, lesbian shows, whores, fucking disgusting, you know.
What's disgusting?
Johnny Sack is very uptight, I think.
Well, what's
sexually
disgusting?
I think I think he's repressed.
When I was in Vegas, I would help certain people came to town with bachelor parties. I was working at the hotel. They would ask if I knew any girls, and I knew a few, and I would call and I would, put them together. And they would have bachelor parties. They had a suite in the hotel. Some famous people, I don't want to name names, but famous people. And one, it worked out so well, their manager sent me a Breitling watch, $3,500 watch.
I went to one bachelor party when I was like 18. For these two guys, they were both from Italy. And we all worked at the same restaurant. And they had the bachelor party in the restaurant. and it was just, they hired, I guess, I mean, they were older. I was one of the younger guys. They were older. They hired two, I guess, they were prostitutes, obviously. And they were sitting in the middle of the room with like 30 guys and...
Yeah. Having, I don't like bachelor parties.
Having sex in front of all of us. It was it was hideous.
I'm not a bachelor party
no,
guy.
No. That was kind of traumatic. I don't know if I've ever gotten over that. That was a lot of
first of all, if you're gonna have a bachelor party, may I suggest, can I make a few suggestions here to our listeners out there? If you're gonna have a bachelor party, have it 3 weeks, a month ahead of time. Don't have it Friday and you get married Sunday. A couple reasons. One, I had friends of mine went out the Friday night. They were getting married the next 2 days later, got into a fight. They were all banged up. The groom had a black eye, all banged up.
It's like The Hangover, like that movie.
In the wedding pictures. Number two, I know another guy, this is no lie, got the clap. Now, how do you explain that? That you can't have sex on your wedding night with your new bride because you got the clap from your bachelor party. Right. So if you do it a month ahead of time and God forbid you got the clap, you could get it cleared up in
time.
There
you go. Practical advice from somebody who knows.
And you could also bullshit and say, and if she wants to have sex, you say, honey, I'm waiting. I want to wait till the wedding night. I don't want to do
this.
Well,
that'd
never
get over. That would never work on anybody. No one's going to buy that line.
Oh, yeah, they'll buy it.
No.
Okay, so that's my suggestion, a bachelor party. But he said, disgusting, I'm not a bachelor party guy.
No, I'm not after that. I've never been since I'm 18. We should do Talking Sopranos bachelor parties. That should be another side ancillary project.
We'll go there. We could do the podcast from The Bachelor.
That's a great idea. I'm telling you.
And interview
you, I think
some of the girls.
People would like
all the guys and the guys. So
and
what
Bachelorette.
Do you think?
We won't discriminate.
No,
Bachelorette
no.
Parties.
What do you think? You're going in there. What's going to happen? Well, you know, how'd you feel in there when they come out? Like a boxing match. How'd you feel in there? Well, you know, I was going around. We were going round and round in front. I think it's a good idea. John used to be very friendly with Little Carmine, he says. They came to me when they needed help.
And Christopher says, I had no idea you guys are that close. It's straight. Shame you can't find a way to work things out. And Tony's just like, motherfucker.
And Tony goes, you know, let me get a piece of bread. It's exactly what he told them not to do. And then when they get outside, he
Well, Chris
screams.
Has a good idea. Let him keep Lorraine, and you take some of his Florida stuff. It's not a good idea.
Keep your ear. He's screaming at him. Keep your ears open, your mouth shut. And he said, "This worst comes to worst, it could work out in our advantage. They fight. We pick up any crumbs from the fallout." Chris, not the brightest move.
No.
Adriana and Agent San Severino in the car. Something I've been meaning to get straight. Tony calls Christopher his nephew, yet sometimes you refer to him as cousins. This whole nonsense of whether he's the nephew, the cousin.
How he's
she
related.
She says it's an Italian thing from the other side. It's bullshit. They're not related by blood. They're not related.
Well, no, but Carmela is Dickie's first cousin. Yes, they're related.
Yeah, but they're not related. They're not related by blood, Tony and him.
Well, on the Blundetto side, because Christopher's mom is a Blundetto. Joanne is Blundetto. So they are related on both sides of the family.
They're very far removed. It is an Italian thing. People call each other cousins a lot.
So like my mother's first cousin, Richie, his name is, I call him Uncle Richie because he's older. You know, and he is somebody, I guess sometimes when they're cousins, but they're a generation older, you call them uncle out of respect. That's an Italian thing, yeah.
So now what about when it's your real aunt, say, your mother's sister, your real aunt, she's married. You call him when you were younger. She's married to Joe. Uncle Joe? Aunt Mary, Uncle Joe.
Not in every case, actually. Sometimes we did, sometimes we didn't.
And then they get divorced, and then what do you call him?
Nothing.
He's gone. He's out of the family. Just like that. Like he never existed. He's out. She says, how long do I have to keep doing this? She said, well, in the Joe Mancino case in New York, it took 7 years to build a RICO case.
That does not go down well with Adriana.
7 years.
Yeah.
Bench on the street, Junior sits, Wanda arrives.
He's looking at the old, that's actually the old Pabst Brewery in Irvington, outside on 14th Avenue. It's now demolished. I didn't know Pabst was made in New Jersey.
I thought it was made in Brooklyn. A lot of breweries in Bushwick, Brooklyn.
There were a lot of breweries in Knickerbocker, Schaefer, that was there. Rangel, Schaefer, yeah.
Schaefer, Rangel, a lot of them. You know, they're coming back. There's a lot of new breweries now.
Microbreweries, they call them.
Yeah.
Craft breweries. Well,
Brooklyn Brewery there. There's a lot of
Brooklyn beer,
there.
Yeah.
And Pabst made a comeback because Pabst was gone for a while, and I think it made a comeback, you know. I also, there's a good show on TV, The Foods That Built America. It's on the History Channel.
And beer is one of them?
Beer. They talked about the guy who... did Pabst, Lay's potato chips, the pizza wars, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, you know, going way back to how it started. Mm. Fritos.
Coca-Cola had cocaine in it. You know really? That, right?
Yeah, well, I read that. They didn't say it on this show.
That's why it's called Coca-Cola. It had actual cocaine. Cocaine was legal at one time, and they had it in Coca-Cola. It was kind of a tonic. It wasn't like just a beverage you drink like for you know, with food or whatever. It was like a pick me up, obviously. You know.
But the 70s, didn't they say in the 70s it wasn't physically addicting, just mentally addicting?
Cocaine.
That was all the way up until the 70s. Yes, wasn't physically addicting. They had said at one point, but it was just, you know, emotionally and mentally.
Really?
You wanted it. You didn't need it physically like heroin, but you wanted it.
Ah.
Junior sits. Do you know me? Jupiter Club on 6th Street, Junior asks.
That's Hilda Evans playing the role of Wanda, in who comes up to him. It's kind of a funny scene there, you know, because... I don't know if either one of them knows what's going on. They're both.
You know my brother Johnny? She said, well, you got the looks, I'll tell you that. She's saying that.
He says, did we have relations? Do you want a date? I got my car. And she offers a half and half. What's a half and half? Do you know? I've never heard of that.
A half and half is a blowjob and a lay. Well, so you pay.
So it's half a blowjob.
Well, she'll blow you for a little while, and then you stoop.
And that's called a half and half.
A half and half. See, right. This show is a plethora of information for people all over the world. Because there's many people don't know what a half and half is.
Yeah,
there's people in Italy, in Brazil.
It's a mezzo mezz in Italy.
There you go, a half and half. I want a date. I'll give you half and half in the back seat. Now I want to go home. I have to find my car. Junior is walking on the bridge.
That's the Central Avenue.
Now it's dark out. It's getting scary. Wow. Trips over the garbage. He's got rips his pajamas, and the cops, he's hiding behind the dumpster. Some ID, sir. Fuck you, copper. I know my rights. My car was stolen. I want my lawyer. Where do you live? Belleville. Sure. You don't want to tell us your name? You're not in trouble or anything? Corrado Soprano. They kind of half laugh.
Don't believe
it. Like, this isn't him. Junior, fantastic here. He doesn't remember the lawyer's name. He says Mel for Melvoin. He can't find the car. Who stole the car? You know who. Who do you think Junior means?
I don't know. That's a good question.
Think he thinks Tony took it?
Maybe. You know, when they're in Junior's house, you see, because he said lay off the Snapple, there's a couple of empty bottles of Snapple and a pizza that's been eaten. You see that? Did you notice that?
Yeah, well, the kid's been peeing the bed.
He didn't lay off the Snapple. Junior's mad. He says, I go out for some exercise. People give you the goddamn third degree.
He tells the cop, go shit in your hat.
Go shit in your hat.
He gives the identification. Tony's house. Janice and Bobby arrive.
Tony's watching His Girl Friday, Howard Hawks movie with Cary Grant.
And he's drinking the beer Löwenbräu, which I don't see around anymore.
Not much, no. It was made by... Was it made by Miller? Or one of the big...
You owe it to Löwenbräu.
Yeah, but it was made by either Budweiser or Miller or something. It was their slightly higher end.
Yeah, fancy, you know, Löwenbräu.
And he's eating fried calamari that Artie brought in from Vesuvio.
Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Artie's around. Bobby, he may have Alzheimer's. Good. Maybe he'll forget my phone number. Fuck him. You reap what you sow. And then they go at it.
You sure did. Don't you? There's a reason why you're all alone. There's a lot I could say that I'm not going to say. And he's saying, you're always pawning everything off. It's all about money here. You went to Tibet. You went to Berkeley. You left me alone with the mother. Free spirit, Janice. Dropping acid, one of my favorite moments. Blowing roadies. And your reaction. Your reaction when you go, roadies? That Bobby just didn't go well. That didn't go down well with Bobby. Pardon the pun.
And she's telling him, you better tell him that's not true. So she cares what Bobby thinks.
Yeah.
Then they go at it like brother and sister, but they're going at it. She hits him, and Artie gets nailed in the elbow, in the eye.
In the eye, yeah.
Artie gets nailed in the elbow. Now, I talked about this with Aida when we were here. They were arguing, her and Jim.
That day?
Her and Jim were arguing that day, and we talked about it on the air. You don't remember, but she wasn't feeling well.
Oh, the chicken salad. That was that.
No, that was up in Soprano Home Movies. This was, we were in the studio, and she wasn't feeling well, and Jim, we shot Jim's side first. And then when it came time to shoot Aida coming in and her stuff, she felt Jim wasn't looking at her. And he was looking at the TV, but he said, I was doing that in the other scene. And they went at it. And they went at it. And they know each other a long time. It very much was like brother and sister. And she was going, don't fuck with me, James. Don't fuck with me, James. Because she always called him James, especially when she was mad. And they had an argument, and it took a while. And they came back, and we got a great scene out of it.
A really great scene. It's awesome.
She hits him. They go at it. Janice is not afraid.
She screams. Yeah, that scream is kind of chilling as well.
You know, Tony had enough. You know, it's a family fight. She's starting shit with Bobby and his kids. And he tells Bobby, you want more responsibility. Start controlling your wife. Not the first time this is happening.
Yeah.
Bobby is not the one to control her.
Nope. It's a very real, physically very real and emotionally. It's great. It's very well done. And really well directed by John Patterson there. He keeps that energy really tense and shoots it.
Well, that's a tough one. I wouldn't want to know that my wife was on the road blowing roadies.
Roadies, though. If it was some other walk of life, maybe you would have been a little more okay with it. Roadies conjured
like
up
what?
All these images of sweaty guys.
Sweaty guys with beards, getting high, drinking.
Backstage.
I'm a roadie fan, but, you know, they live rough. You know, they live rough. That's the life they choose. They go from city to city. They're with all kinds of girls. That's the thing. There were all kinds of girls in every city. They get a lot of the leftovers of the stars. They do pretty well, roadies. They're well respected. They do good work. The band trusts them. But, you know, so what would be good? Like, you know, she was dropping acid and blowing school teachers?
Maybe, yeah.
She Doctors, was dropping, surgeons. Dropping acid and blowing surgeons at the hospital. She was blowing deli workers.
No. Stand-up comedians.
Dropping acid and blowing comics. Dropping acid and blowing cab drivers. No.
No.
No. Dropping acid and blowing a bunch of Wall Street executives.
That's okay. No. No? Bankers. She'd go to the bank to make a deposit
A bunch of tellers. Blowing a bunch of, how about this? She went to Coney Island. She was dropping acid and blowing a bunch of carnies. No.
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 Carnies?
No, carnies. No blowing carnies. a pork store back room. Tony meets with Paulie and Feech.
Paulie lies and says that the guy jumped out of the tree and went at him with a chainsaw.
Tony, what's incredible here, so they make it, they split the area. East of Dyer is yours, west of Dyer goes to him. $500. Tony says, I told the guy 12. He gets a grand. And, of course, Tony wants a piece of this.
Well, he wants a piece, incredible. And he's also saying, why haven't I been getting a piece? And Feech, who's just a liar, says, it's a new venture. My nephew's barely on his feet. I didn't want to start kicking up and then pull back. It's all bullshit. He wasn't going to kick up if he didn't have to.
Paulie meets with Salvitro. Paulie's a weasel. He says, I got you 500. He pocketed 500. Off this poor, all this guy is trying to do is make a living. That's all he's trying to do.
He pocketed 500. He pocketed the guy's 500. And now he's only got half his route. And he's got to make do with it. And that's it.
And he's got a comp. He's gonna have to comp a couple of lawns.
He's gonna comp the bosses. Yeah, he's in way worse situation than he was before.
Oh yeah. Now, but what about this other? Paulie tells the other guy, "My middle name's Paul."
Right.
My middle. Did you get that?
Yeah.
My middle name's Paul.
Because his name is Peter.
Oh really?
Peter Paul Gualtieri. Yeah, that's his real name.
Oh, where did that come up? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Why didn't I know that?
I think his real name is Peter Paul Gualtieri, if I'm not mistaken.
The golf course, Dr. Winner.
Dr. Weiner is a neurologist, and Matt Weiner's father was also a neurologist. So I don't know. I don't think Matt Weiner's father was named Harry, but he was Dr. Weiner, and he was a neurologist.
I was your mother's neurologist. I did her work from Green Grove. Your sister told you I'm treating your uncle. He says that we don't talk much. And he tells him he's been suffering from a bunch of small strokes, mini strokes. Do you find they'll ask the same question every 3 minutes?
He's obstinate.
I don't know, maybe.
Impatient, forgetful.
Sounds like me. Sounds like me. I don't have dementia.
You're not forgetful.
I don't think.
You don't repeat questions. You are obstinate and impatient, but you don't. But you're not forgetful, you're okay. You don't check all the boxes, so don't worry about it.
All right.
But that seems to get through to Tony. That makes him pause and kind of reassess. You know what's been going on between him and Junior.
Tony says he's a hostile prick.
Right, but after he hears his diagnosis, then he kind of softens a bit. You could see.
Johnny Sack's house, a huge lawn.
Huge lawn. Huge lawn. He's got to do it for free. And this is because of Christopher. Because Tony says after Christopher opened his mouth in the restaurant to John and pissed off Johnny Sack, he goes, now I got to do something nice for Johnny to make up for this. And that's what it is. So Christopher opened his mouth. Now this poor guy's got to
Tony, nickel and dime, this poor guy's got to do this huge lawn. You feel bad for him. He plays a great role. He winds up doing 4 episodes, Loomis still.
And he's going to have to do this forever, probably, as long as Johnny Sack's living there. There's no going back once you're in there.
As long as he's in business.
As long as he's in business, as long as Johnny Sack lives there, he's got to mow his lawn.
Junior's house, Tony arrives.
Great scene.
He thinks it's probably a beautiful scene.
This is a wonderful scene, yeah.
Beautiful scene, well written, well acted. Tony, I heard you had a little problem. Just take your medicine, Uncle June. It'll make you feel better, help with your memory. Believe me, there's plenty I'd like to forget. You and me both.
Yeah, you and me both. That's a good line. He says he sees the the box or the bag of LaManna Bakery. Oh, Feach was here. He's here paying his respects. What happened? You ruled against Feach, so Feach is a snake. He's
but he remembers. But he goes back a long time with Junior. Obviously, they're more the same age. You know, Junior also says, "Don't forget, I'm the boss of this family, despite any arrangement." You know, Tony brings up the varsity athlete stuff again. Why do you have to be so mean? Why can't you repeat something good? And Junior's in and out on this. He's not completely out of it.
No.
You know, he's in and out. You know, he remembers some stuff. Your doctor said, take your medicine. Who, Kennedy? He said, no, Kennedy's your cancer doctor. You know?
Why can't you say something good if you're repeating stuff? And then that last line, that's just amazing when he says, don't you love me?
And Junior's holding back tears.
Junior's holding back tears. Tony's kind of holding back tears. It's just a very touching and kind of strange moment as well between the two of them. It's a quiet one and a heavy one. Great.
You know, you got to remember, you know, besides the mob stuff, Junior was like a father to Tony. He took him to the ball games. He took him to the park.
He played
ball with him. You know, they've had some rough times, and now here comes, you know, Tony, you know, they had the cancer scare, he's had other scares, but now he's starting to lose his memory, and that's a bad moment when that happens, you know? You know what's, you know, bad? When people have dementia, especially at the beginning, they know it. So you know what's happening, and there's nothing you could do about it. There's nothing you could do about it. A beautiful scene. Beautiful scene. Well acted. Very poignant.
All right. Now it's time
good
for
episode.
The talking. Very good episode. Time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA Best Question of the Week is Mike from Richmond, Virginia. We will send Mike a pair of Bose headphones.
Mike asks, when looking at other mobster movies, The Godfather, Goodfellas, Black Mass, Once Upon a Time in America, where do you feel The Sopranos would be rated on a scale of 1 to 10? What do you think?
Well, I mean, it's a hard comparison because The Sopranos is 86 hours compared to, you know, Godfather. You know, Godfather 1 and 2 together is about, what, 6 or 5? You know, I mean, a lot of people say Godfather, Goodfellas, and The Sopranos are like the three great works of mob, you know, on screen, those three. And I would agree, you know, Godfather and Goodfellas are both fantastic. They're very different movies.
Yeah.
But
Black Mass was okay.
I didn't see Black Mass. Once Upon a Time in America is really good. Especially I like the long version. There's two versions of it. I like the longer version. It's a good movie.
I mean, Casino was a good mob movie.
Yeah. I think Godfather, Goodfellas, and Sopranos are on their own level. They're the top of the top.
I think I give The Sopranos a 10.
Yeah.
In this genre. It's like an 80. Let's look at The Sopranos as an 86-hour movie.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I give Godfather, Goodfellas, Sopranos 10s. Everything else
absolutely.
Is a little bit below.
You know, Casino was a good movie. We've talked about some of the great mob
Mean
movies.
Streets is a good one.
It was a good one. I wasn't crazy about
it. Oh,
that.
I love Mean Streets. I think Scarface is a good. I mean, that's Scarf, more. That's
it got
a good
better
one.
As the years went on. There's the older ones, you know, Little Caesar and, you know, the James Cagney older ones that are great and Humphrey Bogart. It's a bunch of those mob movies and they have a mob presence, you know. There's some funny ones. Married to the Mob was a pretty good one, you know. But this is the Godfather, Goodfellas, and The Sopranos, to me, are the top three. People will say The Irishman. What are some good mob movies? I don't know. Trying to think of whatever I want to think. People will say, what about this and what about that and what about this? And there's some great ones. I'm not saying these are the only ones, but I think these are the best
You
ones.
Like Once Upon a Time in America?
I saw it a long time ago. It's pretty good.
It's pretty good. It's there's some great stuff in that one.
There's a lot of good, you know, a lot of good movies. Of course, 110th Street was a good one. I mean, there's a lot of good ones. There's a lot of horrible ones.
Oh, quite a few horrible ones, yes. Without a doubt.
There's a lot of horrible, horrible mob movies of this genre. They're making them today just beyond horrible, you know, like cartoonish, you know. You know, there's a lot of that. You know, I don't know. I'll be honest with you. It's going to be hard to beat The Godfather, Goodfellas, or The Sopranos. It's going to be hard to beat.
Probably
the bar
impossible.
Is set very high.
Impossible
very
to
high.
Beat. I mean, maybe some work of art can be up there with that. That would be hard, but you can't beat those. They're pretty much perfect.
You know, Boardwalk was a great, mob series, you know, different era, that was a great series. You know, mob movies, I mean, whenever these movies are on, you watch them.
Yeah.
I like Godfather 2 the best. I love all that stuff.
To me, Godfather and Godfather 2 are almost like one movie in a way. They weren't made that far apart, you know, so they look like they came from the same time. I don't really separate the two, but I can't choose one or the other. Godfather 2 is longer. It's two places in time. It's, you know, going back before.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
he came to America and after. But I love the Brando, you know, his stuff. And I like Godfather 1. I think it's incredible. When I was a kid, NBC, I believe, aired something called The Godfather Saga, which aired on TV. It was edited for network television, but I think it was over 5 nights, and it was they edited it in chronological order. So it was Godfather 1 and 2 put together in chronological order.
Yeah, they do that. You catch that on cable.
Yeah, I saw that. That was kind of cool as a kid. That's not how it was meant to be done. I didn't see Black Mass.
Black Mass was good. Whitey Bulger. The Boston Mob, that
Departed,
whole story.
Did you like that?
Johnny Depp was good. Departed, I liked.
Yeah,
it's a good one.
It's good.
Good, solid one. Good, solid movie. I mean, I just don't think as good, but a great movie, actually. I liked The Departed. So, very good. Mike, good question. Where is Mike from? Oh, he's from Richmond,
Virginia.
Virginia. There you go, Mike. Enjoy your headphones. And here we go. Thanks for listening. And remember, new episodes release every Monday. Please subscribe to Talking Sopranos Podcast on YouTube, Apple Music, Spotify, Amazon, or wherever you get your podcast. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram and like us on Facebook. Talking Sopranos merchandise. Steve Schirripa motherfucks the world mugs.
There's interest. To syndicate this with other celebrities doing their own Motherfuck the World. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm fielding some offers. I'll get back to you next week about who wants to kind of syndicate this and be part of it.
Okay.
I think this can be its own franchise.
We're a franchise.
Yeah. So I'll get back to you with some of the... I'm getting some interest, and I'll get back to you with that.
I like it. The Talking Sopranos merchandise on TalkingSopranos.com. We got tank tops, t-shirts, hats. Take a look. You might like some. And please follow us on our YouTube channel.
Executive producer Jeff Sussman, our producer, nominated for best producer of a podcast under the circumstances, whatever that means, is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amatin. You can hear more of Elijah's music and the band Zopa, which Elijah and I play in together by clicking the links at TalkingSopranos.com. Our production crew includes Ty Verderam, Sierra Schirripa. We record Talking Sopranos at NYC Podcasting in the lovely Lower East Side of Manhattan. NYC Podcasting is New York's premier podcasting studio. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
All right, man.
See you next week.
I'm looking forward to see who wants a franchise.
Yeah. I'll get back to you on that.
All right.
See you later.